Well, good morning, folks, and it is good to see you. Appreciate your being here. I'd like to, we will take a couple of breaks this morning along the way, but let's make it informal. If you want to get up and stretch or go fetch something, why, don't be reluctant to do that, but I'll just keep plowing on for a time. Again, I thought it'd be good to just quickly review what we talked about last night, and because it really does set the scene. And I began with this reference to Luke 13 and the promise that Jesus made to some Pharisees that you'll not see me until you cry out, blessed. And what he means is that city of Jerusalem will not see me until you welcome me as king, until you cry out, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And as I said to you last night, had you been there that night, that afternoon or whatever, you would have thought that's not going to happen. It did happen, and I believe it happened because Jesus caused it to happen, that he was, in fact, remarkably clever, and that he was committed to using whatever resources on he needed to in order to get done what the Father had for him. And he makes that promise, and then some weeks later, he stays there in Perea, where he is safe because it is the jurisdiction of Herod Antipas. Remember this, who is not so manipulable by the Jewish leaders. But then some weeks later, he comes over to Bethany and raises Lazarus from the dead. And John is explicit that there were at least these three results of the raising of Lazarus from the dead, which happens just a few weeks before the Passover at which Jesus will die. And first of all, the Sanhedrin determines to put Jesus to death. And as we said to you, and that's going to become important this morning, Jesus now is he's on the run. He's a fugitive. He's a wanted man. Secondly, Jesus took himself and his disciples to a little village called Ephraim, and that's explicit in John 11:54, and that's a very, very strategic place right on the border of Samaria, where he would not be confronted by the Jewish leaders for some, we don't know how long, but for some days maybe, as he waits for the timing to be right, because then Jesus made his way. And I gave you this yesterday, but I'm going to be very quick. I just want to get to the chart. Let me go a little further here. Forgive me. I should have had this set up. All right. Jesus is here in Ephraim. This is Ephraim right here. And can you see that? Matter of fact, let me do this. Ephraim is down here, and notice that it's just north of Jerusalem. This is Jerusalem. So just north of Jerusalem lies the little city. There are a couple of sites, archaeological sites, and that claim to be that. One is a city called Ophrah, O-P-H-R-A-H, seems to remember Ephraim. But at any rate, Jesus tarries there. But then again, he said this last night, but watch what happens on the map. Jesus sets out from Ephraim. And the Bible says, Luke 17:11, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee, which seems counterintuitive because that means he's going north. Why would he be going north? Well, again, I think he does that in order to fall in with a band of Passover pilgrims that, I got to get out of this. That's my problem. Here. So he makes his way north up to the Valley of Jezreel and falls in with those Passover pilgrims. Now he knows that it is their wont to make the trip to Jerusalem via the rift route. Remember this? So down the Herod Valley and down the Jordan Rift and then reford the river and up to Jerusalem. Well, not to Jerusalem. He goes up the backside of the Mount of Olives, which is where the road, this is the ascent of Adumim. This is the road from Jericho to Jerusalem. But he comes up to Bethany, just outside of Jerusalem, and turns off and goes down to Bethany to keep the Sabbath with the family, Lazarus and his family, and the people go on into the city, and they are bearing a twofold message. I said to you last night, number one, Jesus is coming. I never mentioned that but this morning, but you remember that the third result that John mentions in John 11, 55 and 56 is that everybody in Jerusalem was wondering, will Jesus come to the feast? It's so important to understand that that's what's, the city is rather abuzz with the question. With the issue, is Jesus going to come to the feast? And now here come these several hundred people, all excited, having watched these miracles and so on, and they communicate to the city, he is coming, he stopped in Bethany, he won't come in on Shabbat, he'll be here Sunday morning. And that's why, and it was spontaneous in the sense that there was no concert, there was no plan, but Jesus had carefully alerted the city to his coming. Now, by the way, I mentioned to you before that I think it's fair to say, and I don't mean to be sure, Jesus, I don't want to identify Jesus with the serpent, but I think when he says to his disciples that because you're going in my name, it's important that you be as wise as a serpent. You remember Jesus in another place said that the sons of Mammon are wiser than the sons of the kingdom, and we need to be wiser. And so, and I say again that Jesus was his humanity was real, and he had to plan and be careful and so on, and he does it with remarkable strategy. And one of the ways in which he does that, by the way, I didn't mention this last night, is staying in Bethany. You know, here I mentioned to you last night how important it is, I think, to think in terms of that culture. And one of the dynamics of the Eastern culture, and this shows up a number of times in the Bible, sometimes it's a bit disconcerting to us, but one of the features of that Eastern culture is that if I receive you into my home, if I accept you as a guest in my house, I am absolutely duty-bound to protect you at whatever cost there might be. I will give my fortune, I will give my life, I will give my family's life to protect you. That's just the way that culture operates. That makes sense to you? I used to travel with a Bedouin bus driver. He was my regular bus driver. We got to be pretty good friends. I don't travel with him anymore. And I would ask him to spend some time just talking about that Arab Bedouin culture. And he'd always make this point, if I accept you into my home, I would surrender anything to protect you. Now, time out real quickly. This shows up a couple times in the Bible. For instance, Lot, when those wicked Sodomites come and he's willing to turn over his daughter, remember his daughters, and we think, what? That's the culture. It also shows up in Judges 19 there at Gibeah, when the Levite and his concubine are in the house and the man offers his concubine ultimately. Well, now, my point is that, and this is what's behind the verse in the 23rd Psalm, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And the fact that you are accepting me and feeding me, I don't have to worry about those enemies because my host is duty-bound to protect me. Well, that becomes very, very important because Jesus goes and stays the entire week of the Passion in Bethany. Now, he had just a few weeks earlier called from the dead one of their citizens, and they love him for it. Plus, he's staying with Lazarus. And so Jesus' enemies, both Roman and Jewish, knew that there would be a major riot if they tried to just spirit him out of Bethany. Does that make sense to you? You got to understand, Jesus got to be thinking this way. He's a fugitive. And so by staying, and Bethany is just off the main road, and that main road is constantly full of people, and all throughout the week, as a matter of fact, might I say this, all throughout his ministry, Jesus used the very superficial but wild-eyed popularity that he enjoyed with the masses to protect himself. How often does the Bible say that Jesus' enemies wanted to take him, but they did not because they feared the people? All right, let's think about that specifically. What does that mean? They feared the people. They feared a riot. And if there's a riot, the Romans have to bring in troops and our heads roll. Does that make sense to you? That's why Jesus' enemies could not just spirit him off somewhere and stone him to death, because they feared the people. You need to understand that, and they feared that there would be a riot. I'll come back to that in just a minute, as a matter of fact. But so I leave it at that. The point is that Jesus comes up from traveling with these people, comes up from Jericho, stops at Bethany. The crowd goes into the city bearing the message. And thus it is, I believe, that on Sunday morning, to the surprise, I think, of everybody but Jesus, as a matter of fact, I often think, imagine how the disciples must have felt. I mean, maybe my imagination's getting away with me here just a little bit, but you think about it, Jesus had about 7 months ago begun to tell his disciples, and once he began, he kept it up and said it again and again, began to tell his disciples that he was going to go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the chief priests and scribes and be killed. So that's a kind of now again, the disciples are not getting it, but they do know that the Sanhedrinists have put a price on Jesus' head, as it were, that he's a wanted man. And by the way, in illustration of this, do you remember when Jesus was there in Perea and the messenger came and said, the one whom you love is sick, Lazarus? And so Jesus tarried a couple of days and he said, we're going to go attend to him. What did Thomas say when Jesus says, we're going to go to attend to Lazarus? Remember what he said? Let's go die with him. Now, that's how dangerous it was for Jesus to go to Jerusalem. And so now Jesus travels with all these people. He sends them into town. The disciples they don't understand this. But the fact of the matter is, on Sunday morning, he sends two of his disciples to a little village just up the hill, Bethphage, and says, fetch the colt and the donkey. And then Jesus goes, and I imagine the disciples with some trepidation, because they know that this city is entirely controlled by the Sanhedrinists, who are determined to kill Jesus. They know that the common man seems to be entirely excited with him, but now they ride up the path, Jesus riding the donkey, and they're with him, and they're going up, and they can hear before they crest the hill, before they can see what's going on the other side, they can hear a lot of commotion, a lot, and they must have wondered, what's going on there? And maybe very possibly it struck fear in their hearts. They thought, what's going on? But now they crest the hill, and here are hundreds of thousands of people throwing their garments down and dancing and singing the Hosanna and saying, basically, be our king. And one other point here, and I'll get going, and that is this, that do you see how thoroughly this confused the disciples? They must have been thinking to themselves, you know, Jesus has been talking about dying, and I don't want to hear it, but this is a good thing here. The whole city, we're on a roll here. The whole city welcoming him as king. Well, this is the triumphal entry, and if you will go in your notes to, it's what I call a day of messianic presentation, and I give you some notes about it on page 8. Oh, you know what, though? It just occurred to me. Before I do, let me take you to page 7. Because something happens on Saturday night. Now, let me confess to you, and I'd love to spend time with it. We don't have a lot of time, but there is some confusion about this. But let me just tell you, on Saturday night, there is a feast in Bethany at the home of a man named Simon. It is a feast in honor of Jesus. Now, by the way, how many of you, have you been to Israel? You ought to get yourself to Israel sooner or later. Have you been there? And one of the things I like to do, it's a minor focus, but it's kind of fun on Saturday night to, if you're in Jerusalem, to like walk up the Ben Yehuda Street, the kind of the happening shops and eateries and so on street, and watch the city come almost magically to life within a few minutes on Saturday evening. Because on Friday afternoon, the city goes to sleep. And that busy, noisy, bustling city just becomes mystically quiet. And that's the coming in of Shabbat. On Friday afternoon, you know Fiddler, right? You remember as they're bustling about, Fiddler on the roof, you know, and Tevye's trying to get in the house and get cleaned up because they're going to bring in Shabbat. That's the Friday evening celebration where they welcome the Sabbath. Then there's the day of quiet and focus on family and God and so on. And then on Saturday evening, as the Shabbat goes out, the city comes very, very quickly back to life. Well, I think that's what's at stake here. Jesus arrived unexpectedly on that Friday afternoon, 6 days before the Sabbath, before the Passover, I'm sorry, 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, John 12, verse 1. And so it would have been a quiet afternoon, and then they kept the Shabbat. But you can imagine that the word began to spread throughout the village of Bethany that the wonder-working Nazarene has come to town, and he's staying with Bethany. We need to have a feast. So on Saturday night at the going out of Shabbat, they gather at the home of Simon, and there Mary anoints Jesus with a spectacularly expensive vial of precious oil. You know, by the way, another little cultural insight, two features of life which were very precious, very expensive in antiquity are scent and color, interestingly enough. You know, exotic scents, spices, were very expensive and so on. And then certain bright colors, of course, were very, very expensive. And so the point is that when Mary, and it was a shock to everybody in the room, everybody in the place. And the Bible is explicit that when she began to dash, I mean, I think, and this is the way I picture it, it's a sort of a reception there. They've gathered to honor Jesus and so on, and the villagers are there, the villagers are there. And maybe there are people clustered here and yon, most of them in the courtyard. That's where most of the living was done. But now Mary slips over, unnoticed perhaps, has a vial of oil, and perhaps uncorks it there. And I think when she did, conversation would have stopped within about 20 feet as everybody went, wow, ooh, wow. I mean, you may never smelt anything that delicious before. And you would have expected her to maybe just take a dab and anoint his forehead with it. That would have been an act of remarkable love and courtesy and hospitality and so on. But she begins to just dash it, and that smell would have exploded, and conversation would have stopped everywhere in the room, and people would have come, what is going on? And every one of us, I think. And the Bible is explicit that all the apostles, not just Judas, they all said, what are you thinking about? You're that whole vial? Do you realize what you're doing? And Jesus said, you leave her alone. And by the way, as far as I can tell, although Jesus had been saying again and again, see it in Luke 18 sometime. I won't take you there, but Luke 18, 31, 34 is one of the places where Jesus says explicitly to his disciples, and that's on the way up to the Passover, which he will die within days of his death. And Jesus said again, all things concerning the Son written concerning the Son of Man are going to come to pass. He's going to be arrested and suffer many things and be killed, and on the third day rise again. And in verse 34, Luke says, but the disciples didn't understand these things. These things were hidden from them. They didn't know what he was saying. I mean, it's stunning the degree to which they didn't get it. But my point is simply this, that Jesus did again and again tell his disciples and others that he was going to die. The one person in the record who got it was Mary. Jesus said, you leave her alone. She has done this against the day of my burial. And I think she got it. Now, the point is that was on Saturday night, and I give it to you there at the bottom of page 7, and I am convinced, for reasons I'll try and explain a little later, I am convinced that this is what so angered Judas. That rebuke. Now, the rebuke was not exclusive to Judas, but but it angered Judas in a way it didn't anybody else, because Judas was unregenerate, and because, listen, you know what? Here's a biblical reality. Sin makes you stupid. It really does. You cling to sin in your life, and it distorts and perverts everything. Everything. And what a rebuke, which was I'm sure a bit stinging when Jesus said to everybody in the room, leave her alone. She's done this against the day of my burial. But of course, Judas is a thief, and he's arguing that you should have given it to the poor, and of course, he would have taken part of it. And the reason, by the way, I don't want to get lost in this, but don't try and psychoanalyze Judas. The reason Judas was lost, the reason he rejected the truth, is because he loved his sin more than he loved what he knew very well to be the truth. And you know what? There won't be anybody in hell about which you can't say that. The only reason a person would ever find himself in condemnation is because he embraced, he loved his sin more than he loved what he knew very well to be the truth. The issue is not confusion, it's rebellion. And Judas was a thief, and he had more light than probably any man who ever lived, and yet he high-handedly sinned against that light because he loved his sin, and therefore his soul spirit became so distorted and so perverted that just a simple, honest, legitimate rebuke that everybody else in the room received as well. Now, why do I say, ouch? Well, all right. Let me just talk to you about it now. This is sort of theoretical. Both Mark and Matthew, Mark chapter 14 and Matthew chapter 26, tell this story, the story of the feast and the rebuke. They tell the story in the midst of their Tuesday night narrative. Now, I got to get to Tuesday night, but on Tuesday night, Judas sneaks off to betray Jesus, all right? And in telling that story, both Mark and Matthew insinuate as a flashback. It's clearly a flashback. It's not, he's not telling it where it happened, but he's, so why do Mark and Matthew tell us the story in the middle of this? All right, now I've gotten into it. What should I do? Go to Matthew 26 real quickly. Folks, honest to goodness, this is a very interesting and instructive illustration of what I mean by harmonizing, where you're going to have to compare the texts and think rather carefully in some places as to how they relate. But in Matthew 26, you have the story of, all right, now I'm getting ahead of myself. It's Tuesday night. And Jesus and his disciples have gone back to Bethany, and Judas sneaks away to a hill south of the city of Jerusalem. To this day, the name of the hill is the Hill of Evil Counsel. That's the name of the place. And the reason is because it's where Caiaphas, the high priest, had a palatial personal home. Now, he also had a priestly villa in the old city, in the city of Jerusalem, but south of the city, on the next hill to the south, is where Caiaphas had a home. And Judas went and sneaked away and made a bargain to betray Jesus. Now, Matthew says explicitly that it was 2 days before the Passover. Jesus says that in verse 2, which means it's Tuesday evening. And then it says in verse 3, the chief priests and scribes and the elders. Time out real quickly here. Chief priests, those are the Sadducees. Those are the guys we know oftentimes as the Sadducees. And the scribes, those are primarily the Pharisees. These guys hate each other. It's significant that they have gathered together to make a plan, because as much as they despise and resist one another, they have found common cause in their determination to get Jesus dead. And so it says, the chief priests and the scribes and the elders of the people. So this is basically the Sanhedrin. Now, just to make sure everybody understands, The Sanhedrin is that body. Rome allowed their constituent peoples a tremendous measure of self-government, especially religiously. And the body of self-government in every town had a Sanhedrin. Sanhedrin simply means council. So every town had a town council. But the big one, the great Sanhedrin, was in Jerusalem, 70 men. It was kind of the Supreme Court and the legislature, all things Jewish wrapped up. And it was always presided over by the high priest. That's Caiaphas. So the Sanhedrinists have gathered at the home of Caiaphas unofficially late on Tuesday, madder than you can imagine. And it says, the chief priest, scribes, and the elders of the people assembled at the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, and plotted to take Jesus by trickery and kill him. You got something like that? Stealthily. The point is, they knew. All right, now you see I fouled this up. But as long as I'm here, I'm going to say this. This is Tuesday night. Sunday, Jesus rode into the city. The whole city welcomed him as king, right? Monday, he returned to the city and cleansed the temple a second time. And then he possessed the temple for two entire days, behaving more messianically than any other time in his ministry. So several weeks ago, because of the raising of Lazarus, the Sanhedrin had put a price on Jesus' head, said, we need to arrest him. What's happened since? Well, he rode into town openly, and the whole city welcomed him as king. And then he came and took over the temple for 2 days at the very season when the Sadducees are getting wealthy by making merchandise of the people, and Jesus ran the whole thing off. The point is that the Jewish leadership is, quite frankly, mad to the point of insanity. And so they gather on Tuesday night, and they say, the man, now think about it. When he rode into the city, the whole city welcomed him. Then when he cleansed the temple on Monday, the whole city cheered him because they despised what went on in the temple. So in the minds of the Jewish leadership, if we try and just arrest him, the city will erupt. We'll have a riot. Think about Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. You've got to understand, through this whole incident, this whole week, the enemies of Jesus, both Roman and Jewish, and you got Pilate sitting here thinking, man, oh man, this is a boiling pot if I ever saw one. This thing could explode. Look what's going on here. So you've got both the Jewish and the Roman leadership just on pins and needles because it looks like there's going to be a riot, but the Jewish leadership is so angry, they get together on Tuesday night. And they say, we got to kill him. We got to take him by trickery. We got to find a stealthy way to arrest him and be rid of him. But they said, and this is the key verse here at this point, they said in verse 5, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar, a riot among the people. Now that's a curious verse because that's Tuesday night. And we know very well that not only did they kill him during the feast season, they killed him on the high day of Passover. So on Tuesday, they're saying we need to be rid of him, but we can't do it during the feast. And yet, we know he's going to die on the feast. How'd that happen? The answer in one word is Judas. Because it says in verse, now, here's where you have to be careful. Because beginning in verse 6, and this is exactly parallel to Mark, but I'll not take you there. Beginning in verse 6, Matthew tells us the story of that feast and the anointing and the rebuke. But look how he tells it. Look at verse 6. When Jesus was in Bethany. So it's told as a flashback. Do you see that? And notice one other very important grammatical issue here, and that is, the story that is suspended in verse 5 is picked up in verse 14. Because in verse 5, the story was just suspended where they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people. Then you have the story of the rebuke. And then in verse 14, it says, then one of the 12 called Judas Iscariot went to the chief priest and said, what are you willing to give me and to deliver him to you? And they counted out 30 pieces of silver, and from that time he sought opportunity to betray him. All right, now, are you with me? The story in John 12 is explicitly put on Saturday night. And yet Mark and Matthew tell the story in the, and I say this very, they don't say it had happened on Tuesday, but they tell the story in the midst of their Tuesday night narrative. Why? Well, go to Luke 22. I'm really ahead of myself here, but this will help. Go to Luke 22. Now, again, are you familiar, folks? I'm sure you are to one degree or another, and you've encountered this, but you have this reality called the three of the Gospels are called synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Why do we call them synoptics? Soon, together, optic, to see. They tend to look at things the same way, in some remarkable ways. And both Matthew and Mark do this same thing where they tell what happened on Saturday night in the middle of their Tuesday night narrative. And there seemed to be a reason for it. Well, interesting enough, you go to Luke 22 and you have exactly the same thing, except he doesn't tell the story of the Saturday night feast. He simply says the feast of the unleavened bread drew near. Unleavened bread is the first day of the Passover cycle. And the chief priests and the scribes sought how they might kill him, for they feared the people. Same thing. Now, it's at this point that both Matthew and Mark tell us the story of how, of the feast and the anointing and the rebuke. But Luke doesn't tell us that story. He simply says, you see it there in verse 3, then Satan entered Judas. Where Matthew and Mark tell us the story of that rebuke, Luke simply says, Satan entered Judas. And that's why I say, I think what we're being told is that the unregenerate, angry, bitter, distorted heart of Judas was so offended, so angered by Jesus' rebuke that it festered for about 3 days. That was on Saturday night, until he finally got opportunity to sneak away and do something about it. Does that make sense to you? On Tuesday night. So I'm going to argue that, as a matter of fact, I'm going to check with Paul when I have a chance, but I wonder, honestly, if Paul is not thinking of this specifically when he says in Ephesians 4, let not the sun go down on your wrath, neither give place to the devil. It's just such an interesting parallel, because the sun set for 3 nights on Judas's wrath, and finally he gave place to the devil. Now, it gave place there, actually. It means give the devil a foothold in your life, a beachhead in your life. And I think, but again, I'm going to say it. I hear people fall into this where Judas was some sort of unwitting, uninvolved victim of Satan or something. No. It's by reason of Judas's wickedness but his unregenerate heart and so on that Satan was able to do this. All right, so I lost my way. Let me just pull it together. Saturday night, John 12, quite clearly, there is a feast. At that feast, there is the anointing and the rebuke. That rebuke, I think, was used by Satan to influence Judas to finally go. And by the way, I've got you in Luke 22. Let me just say this real quickly. This is huge. There is a great deal of confusion as to why, or specifically, what was Judas hired to do? What was he paid to do? And folks, there is the notion, and you run into it all the time, that he was hired to identify Jesus, as if the Sanhedrin just wanted to arrest Jesus, but they couldn't pick him out of a lineup, you know? Well, now, wait a minute. On Sunday morning, Jesus rode into the city on a donkey. There's not a set of human features, no more universally recognizable than that of Jesus the Nazarene, okay? So where does that notion come from that he was hired? It's the kiss. The one whom I kiss, that's the one. The kiss was for the soldiers. This is another dynamic you need to understand. In point of fact, Rome did allow her constituent peoples, the Jews in this case, a great deal of self-rule, but they were not allowed any force of arms. And so they could have no police force, no standing army. On the other hand, there were soldiers that would be loaned to the leaders, to the Sanhedrinists, when necessary. And so they're going to be assigned, in fact, a whole cohort of soldiers. 600 is what that means, soldiers. That's what it says in John 18, that when Judas came and Jesus was arrested, he came with a cohort of soldiers. It's the soldiers who need the identifying marks. That makes sense to you? The kiss is for the soldiers. On the other hand, what was Judas hired to do? It is explicit in verse 6, and it is all important. Luke 22, verse 6, says that they gave him the money, and he promised to betray him to them in the absence of the multitude. This is what we're back to. Jesus was a genius. He was clever, and he was careful never to allow himself to be in a place where he could be taken. And again, the curious reality is that the fascination, and I think that's the appropriate word, Jesus was just, the people were fascinated with him. And he was the best show in town on any given day, if you don't mind. And he was healing for many months, everybody who came to him. And so the point is that Jesus had these huge crowds. Now, they are going to prove themselves to be entirely fickle, superficial. And as soon as Jesus demands anything of them, they turn back. But as far as I always say, and this is one of those 10 insights I gave you at the beginning of the notes there, I always say that, understand that number one, that there were two really important results of this superficial but wild-eyed popularity that Jesus was afforded. Does that make sense to you? Number one, it protected him from his enemies, and they couldn't take him. It says again and again, they wanted to take him, but they could not because they feared the multitude, the people. So number one, this popularity protected Jesus from his enemies. Number two, it totally confused his disciples because he kept talking about dying, and it's just getting better and better and better. So you got to factor that in very consciously when you're tracing the narrative here. All right, too much time. I'm supposed to be talking about the triumphal entry, for heaven's sake. Folks, I'm trying to be a good teacher here. Sunday, day of Messianic presentation, it's the triumphal entry. Now, I got to talking about something that happened on Saturday night, and because it shows up in the record on Tuesday evening, I'm trying to sort it all out. Does that make sense to you? But the feast and the anointing and the rebuke happened on Saturday night. Then the next morning, Jesus did, in fact, dispatch his disciples to fetch that donkey and the colt, and now he rides into the city. And now, if you go to page 8, I'm going to be very quick here because we want to get through the week this morning. I make the point here on page 8 that there are at least these three lines, and I'd like to speak of them about them very, very quickly. Three lines of specific Old Testament predictive prophecy which come together on this day. First of all, the manner. Do you see it there? Zechariah 9:9 says, "Behold, O Jerusalem, your king comes unto you, meek and lowly, riding on a donkey," and so on. Now, I'm going to be very quick about this, but folks, you need to stop and contemplate this for just a moment. It is absolutely, how do you expect a king to enter his capital city? Horseback, very good. You would expect all sorts of the accoutrements of royalty, banners and military presence and heralds and trumpets and so on. And it is staggering that Jesus rode in on a donkey, and it may be that the donkey was kings actually usually rode on donkeys in antiquity because the stallion, if you don't mind, was a military animal, and the idea was evidently that if you're riding on a donkey, things are under control. You know what I'm saying? You don't. But however you like that, Jesus has none of the accoutrements of royalty, and yet the city welcomes him explicitly as a king. Everything about what they're doing, the throwing down of the garments and the singing the Hosanna and the singing the, all of that is explicit expression in a Jewish setting of the way you welcome a king. So it really is kind of staggering that in Zechariah 9, it says that he will come meek and lowly, and yet he will be, your king comes unto you. All right, so the manner of his coming had been foretold. And then secondly, and there's some debate about this, and I'm going to be very quick, and some of you I know have encountered it before, but I think that very possibly the moment of his coming. Now, I realize this is a lot to lay on you, and I just give you that chart that, all right. very simply, this is extra, okay? Don't worry about this. But I am convinced in Daniel chapter 9, you have a remarkable prophecy. And that prophecy says, and I'm going to cut through all of the verbiage and so on and just give you the simple message of the prophecy, that from the going forth of a certain commandment to rebuild Jerusalem, that's the commandment given to Nehemiah on Nisan 1 of 444 B.C., from the going forth of a commandment to restore and rebuild Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince will be 483 years. Now that's what it says. It says that quite specifically. There is some debate out as to how to understand those years, and I would argue that they are prophetic years, but I think you can make this case, and I'm just going to say it this simply. I think you can make this case that if you understand Daniel 9 aright, and if you do the arithmetic, that starting on Nisan 1, 444 B.C., or I give you the date here, starting on March 4th, 444 B.C., right here, and you count forward those 483 years, 69 times 7, it comes out to that many days, and it brings you to March 29, 33 A.D., which is the day Jesus rode into Jerusalem. Now, I believe this with two or three fibers of my being. You know what I'm saying? You could talk me out of this, maybe. But I think the case can be powerfully made, and I will say this, that by any calculation, there are a lot of factors here that are much debated by biblical students, but the fact is, by any calculation, it's going to come out within weeks of that day. And clearly there is a clock that begins to tick in 444 BC, and that alarm is going off. That makes sense to you? And everybody knows one of the interesting realities about the first century AD. And everybody who studies it, everybody, secular and biblical historian, will acknowledge that there was a fever pitch of messianic expectation at this point in history. And most scholars throw their hands up in the air and they say, we don't know why. You know why they don't know why? Because they deny that Daniel is a real prophet, for heaven's sakes. If you accept Daniel as a biblical prophet who did write 500 years before Christ and who said, from the going forth this commandment unto Messiah the Prince will be exactly this many years, you do what you will as far as the fine tuning of that chronology. The fact is, it's going to come out right here. Does that make sense to you? Now, I think it comes out on the day. And it is fascinating to me, that, and I think this is what perhaps gives the greater significance to that command in Psalm 118, verse 24, where we are told that when Messiah appears, you're to sing, this is the day which the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And it's really interesting to me that as Jesus left the city that day, he wept over it, and he said, O Jerusalem, if only you knew what belonged to you on this thy day. So I think, but certainly the point is that, you know what? All right, the point is that God predicted with one degree of surgical precision or another the time at which Messiah would appear. And Jesus appeared at that time. I have a dear friend in Israel by the name of Menno Kalischer. I don't get to see him as much as I'd like, but you know Menno, he's a pastor there. He started a wonderful, he's still going, but He put together a gospel presentation. It's 8.5 by 11, you know, multicolor. But he goes through Daniel 9, and he just points out, this is what, to the Jewish people, this is what your scriptures say. That starting with this commandment, can't be any mistake, you got to count that many years. And his point is, if it's not Jesus, who is it? Because your scriptures say that he's got to come in this season. I'll leave it alone. There's more to say. But, all right, so at any rate, I think the meaning, I'm sorry, I say that on your sheet that the I'll go back to it. At the triumphal entry. All right, where's my... I say that there are these three lines of Old Testament prophecy. First of all, the manner of his coming, and that is he'll come meek and lowly. And secondly, I think the moment in Daniel 9, but maybe most importantly, and this is where I want you to focus for a minute, the meaning of Messiah's coming. And I'm getting that from Psalm 118, verse 25, where Israel is commanded to cry out, Hoshana, save now. The meaning of the Messiah of the triumphal entry is that Messiah, the Savior, has delivered. Now, the deliverer has appeared. They were instructed to receive their Messiah as their Savior. Save now. Now, folks, let's talk for a minute. There's a lot of confusion here. You know, as I said to you last night, the word Messiah had, by the New Testament, had come to pretty much wrap up everything the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures, said about this coming deliverer. And frankly, I am a fire-eating premillennialist. Now, if that doesn't mean a lot to you, I'll just leave it at that. I believe that Jesus is going to come and reign on this earth. I believe there is a kingdom yet to come, and it is Jesus who is going to come and powerfully put in place that kingdom. Does that make sense to you? All right, now having said it, here's the point. When we think of Messiah, we tend to think of his role as political deliverer and king ruling over a physical, literal kingdom. Amen and amen. That's an Old Testament hope. I've had students say to me over the years, and not infrequently, well, wait a minute, Bookman. Remember I said to you last night that Jesus made these two claims concerning himself. He claimed to be the Christ. He claimed to be the Son of the living God. And I've had people say, well, wait a minute. Why didn't he claim to be the Lamb of God, the Savior of the world, the Savior from sin? Folks, that is what is most basic to the title Messiah. Where does the messianic hope begin in the Old Testament? Where do you have the first promise of a deliverer? Genesis 3. Simple question. When Adam and Eve, who were, by the way, happy eavesdroppers, God was speaking to the serpent. But he said, this is not over. And I am going, this is God speaking to the serpent. I am going to the devil. I am going to raise up one of the seed of the woman who will crush your skulls. The picture of a victor with his foot on the neck of his vanquished enemy. And there is one who is going to come. Now, here's my question. Adam and Eve, who had known what it was to walk in the cool of the day with God, who had enjoyed perfect, bottomlessly delightful and satisfying fellowship with the one who called them into existence. But now they had sinned and they had plunged themselves into alienation and death and despair. And for the first time now, can you imagine how their heart leapt as they heard this promise? God is going to raise up a deliverer. All right, here's my question. When they heard that, did their heart leap because they contemplated, they anticipated deliverance from Rome or from sin? Not a tough question, right? You see, where I'm taking you here, you have to understand. Look, you have, in the Old Testament, there is this, in the Bible, theologians use this phrase, and I love it, and I think there's a lot of truth to it. We talk about progressive revelation. And what we mean by progressive revelation, quite frankly, is that God didn't just back the whole 18-wheeler up to the Garden of Eden and dump it down and say, okay, Adam, you sort through that. You know what I'm saying? You just work it all out. The fact is, God knows that he's working. I like to say God is an infinitely wise teacher, and he knows that he is working with almost infinitely slow students. You know what I'm saying? And so the fact is that God has carefully parceled out truth. You can trace it in Scripture. And so you have an initial seed promise. And what I mean by it is it's a seed in the sense it's just in seed form. Now, it's a promise of the seed of woman as well, but you have this initial promise. And it's going to grow throughout the Old Testament. And we're going to learn so much more about who this one is. That makes sense to you? We're going to learn. And in the course of time, God's going to make a covenant with a people called Israel. And he's going to promise them if they keep up in their sin, he's going to allow Gentiles to rule them. And then he's going to reveal that this Messiah is also going to be the one who delivers them from that Gentile rule and so on. That's yet to come. But the fact of the matter is that the whole hope starts in Genesis 3. And that's what's most basic, most seminal to what's going on. So anytime Jesus speaks of himself as the Messiah, you need to, and he expects his hearers to understand that he means, first of all, he is going to deliver them from their sin. Does that make sense to you? That's most basic. Question? No? So the point is that when it says in Psalm 118 that when Messiah appears, you receive him as your Savior. And that means most fundamentally, is there a secondary blessed element of deliverance from Gentile rule? Yeah, that's clear in Daniel chapter 2. That stone cut out without hands rolls out and pulverizes Gentile kingdoms, remember that, the statue, the image that Nebuchadnezzar dreamed about and becomes a fifth world kingdom, praise God. And in Daniel 7, when you have the four beasts and then the Ancient of Days takes his seat and he dispatches one called, who does the Ancient of Days dispatch? What is Jesus' favorite title for himself? 81 times, that's right, he calls himself the Son of Man, right out of Daniel 7, where the Ancient of Days, God sits on his throne and dispatches the Son of Man, one like unto a Son of Man, to establish a fifth world kingdom. So, is it true? Bless God, it is true. And I can't wait. I'm hungry for the day when Jesus rules on this earth physically, and the knowledge of the glory of the Lord covers the earth as water covers the sea. There's a whole theology that believes that that's in place today. Is that true here in Annapolis? Because it ain't working so well in Cary, North Carolina, I'll tell you the truth. But I'm being a little bit flipped. But the point is that, praise God, that is a legitimate and delightful part of what the Bible ultimately teaches about what this Messiah is going to accomplish. But it all begins in Genesis 3 with deliverance from the curse of sin. And Jesus expects. Now, I ask the question here. I'm going to cut to the chase. That's too late for that, isn't it, Bookman? But because I asked the question last night, given Sunday, why Friday? Given the fact that on Sunday the city is seemingly so willing to receive Jesus as king, why by Friday are they calling for his crucifixion? Same city, same crowd. And I like to say, if the question is, give it Sunday, why Friday, I would suggest that the answer is Monday and Tuesday. Now, I'll say it again. Given Sunday, why Friday? And I think the answer is Monday and Tuesday. Now, I need to tease this out a little bit, and I need to be very quick about Monday and Tuesday, because by the time I send you home early this afternoon, trust me, but we need to get through Friday morning. But let me talk to you about Monday and Tuesday. I call them days of messianic proclamation. You have a lot of notes covering them. Beginning on page 9, very simply, I've got stuff in a PowerPoint, but I think I'm just going to walk you through it we'll see. On Monday morning, Jesus returns to the city. Along the way, fascinatingly enough, he encounters that fig tree. I'd love to spend time with it, but we'll have to do it another time perhaps. And he comes back to the city, and for a second time, he cleanses the temple. Now, let me show you something here. You need to, this is another issue or place where you see Jesus just absolutely as wise as a serpent. Here, I think you're perhaps familiar. I'd love to spend some time with it, but I'll just be very quick. This is Lane Rittmeyer's Very, very helpful drawing, reconstruction of what the temple looked like. Here is a model from Jerusalem. There's a model at the Israel Museum. Now understand that this area out here, all of this area on both sides, is what's called the court of the Gentiles. Then this area right here is called the court of the women, and this is actually the court of Israel. So you have these three courts, and this large outer court was, and it's 35 acres. What's your footprint here? Kevin, you got any idea? 5 or 6 acres? So, 35 acres. You can get 250,000 people in there, and they do every year at Ramadan. So here again is here, these areas right here are the large outer courts. And these pillars you see all the way around are called stoa or porches, and they're places for just public assembly, and they've got some acoustical qualities and so on. But the other side of it is, remember this, that this is an oral culture. They know how to listen. They know how to learn as they listen. I'm talking memorize. I think you could take, we have this, like I say, the hubris of modernity. We think we're so smart and so on. Folks, the people in antiquity were so much smarter than we are. Honest to goodness. I hate to be hard on anybody, but I think you could take a guy off the docks of Caesarea Maritima in the first century, and if you could transport him whole here, he would make a fabulous living doing maybe nightclubs or whatever, feats of memory that we would regard as totally superhuman. And he would think, what are you talking about? That's just, their minds were trained. They were an oral culture. They didn't have, they didn't have these, for heaven's sakes, these crutches that we all depend on so terribly. So the point is that they could learn as they listened. They could spread it. So you could talk to thousands of people absent any, so electronic amplification. So the point is, this area, these two large, this court of the Gentiles had been specifically designed for Gentiles. And the point is that the Sanhedrinists, and primarily the Sadducees, had used that territory to, all right, very quickly. I think you're familiar with this. But number one, Passover is the one feast, the one of the three major feasts, Passover, Pentecost, Tabernacles, where every individual offers a sacrifice. And the sacrifice had to be offered, of course, at the temple. And most people would buy that lamb along the way or when they got there. And the local, the Sadducee, because after you bought the lamb, then you had to take it to the priests and have it inspected. And they realized they had a good thing going for themselves here. And so they pretty much made it known that they would only accept animals that had been purchased from shepherds who would give them a piece of the action. There's a whole kickback thing going on, and you were paying above market price and so on. And in many cases, I think we ought to bring Hophni and Phinehas to this. I think it's kind of an echo of what was going on in 1 Samuel 2. But the point is that in many cases you were probably being sold a lamb which was Levitically deficient, which really didn't qualify, but nonetheless the priests were in charge. I always say you couldn't go down the street and start the Second Baptist Temple, if you know what I mean. So you're stuck with this one, and you're stuck with this priesthood. And then, of course, in order to build this marvelous, marvelous Second Temple, now the Second Temple was built by Zerubbabel in Ezra 1, but Ezra 1 to 6, but of course Herod came along and remodeled it just beyond what we can imagine. And in order to do that, Rome allowed him to place a 2-day tax on every Jew in the world. And you say to yourself, and by the way, the temple was the greatest cash cow Herod ever invented. This was just a cash cow. But you might say, well, how is he going to collect that? He didn't have to collect it. Every little village of Jewish folk anywhere in the Roman world would every year take up their offering and give it to, put a small army together and march in big celebration and so on, come marching into Jerusalem and give their taxes, their temple tax. So the point is that the Passover, at Passover, very simply, at Passover, the Sadducees who ran the temple made horrible merchandise of the common man, but they made themselves filthy rich doing it. And the common man despised it. And so now, and there are two times, now in order to appreciate this, and I have this chart here, so I'm going to throw it up here. You've got to understand the difference. This is the sort of the bottom line. This is what you need to know about the Pharisees versus the Sadducees. Very simply, what it comes down to is this. The Sadducees run the temple. The Pharisees run the synagogues. Now, the synagogue was the center of every Jewish person's life. It wasn't a church, and it wasn't the temple. There were no sacrifices at the temple, at the synagogue, of course. The synagogue was a gathering place. And I like to say it was the union hall where you went to find work. It was the dating parlor where you went to find a spouse for your children. It was the news center where you went to catch up on everything that was going on. It was the place you'd go to check with the rabbi about wisdom and so on. So your life was centered on the synagogue, and the Pharisees ran the synagogue in sort of a de facto fashion. On the other hand, the Sadducees ran the temple, and that was de jure. They had paid a heavy price to the Romans to give them control in the temple. And as I say there, the Pharisees believed the entire law, including the oral law, the traditions of the Father. The Sadducees were functional unbelievers. They had entirely embraced Greco-Roman philosophy, and they rejected the idea of a bodily resurrection and so on. But here's the big rub. The Pharisees, remember this, were respected. I like to say they were revered. The Pharisees were revered and feared by the common people. That's so big. The Sadducees, on the other hand, were despised by the common people. Does that make sense to you? Now, that's what you need to know. Now, watch this. Think with me. This isn't in your notes. There are four, just take my word for it. There are four Passovers in Jesus' ministry. At two of those Passovers, the first, John 2, and the fourth, all three synoptics, Jesus cleansed the temple. And there is such cleverness in this. Because, now just think about it. Very early in Jesus' ministry, just after the first miracle there at Cana, just within weeks of that undoubtedly, Jesus goes up to Jerusalem for Passover. He evidently, as a child, it says explicitly that he went every year, and I imagine that was his habit. He'd go every year. But in John chapter 2, for the first time after he had commenced his public ministry, Jesus goes to the temple, and he drives out the money changers and the hawkers and so on. And, all right, number one. Whose turf is he on? Sadducees. Now, how do you think they feel? Have you ever asked about, how do you get away with that? Well, think about it. Number one, how do you think the common man reacted to that? Oh, this is the most exciting thing we've ever seen in our lives. And remember, Passover is a pilgrimage festival. Jews from all over the land and all over the world, they're going home talking about nothing but this crazy Nazarene who took a cord and began to throw the tables over and drive those animals right off the Temple Mount and say, "You'll not make my father's house a house of thieves, a den of thieves." This is the most exciting thing they'd ever seen. But I go back to it. How did he get away with it? Well, number one, you see how, all right, when Jesus cleansed the temple for the first time, he accomplished, I think, three ends. Number one, he instantaneously catapulted himself into notoriety. It's so clever. Everybody would have been talking about this. Every Jew in the world would have been going home talking, "You can't believe this guy." Number one, he catapulted himself into notoriety, which means what? His enemies, in this case the Sadducees, can't just grab him and take him off and stone him because there's going to be a riot, and if there's a riot, their heads are going to roll. So, but number two, I think this is deliberate on Jesus' part. He pitted the Pharisees against the Sadducees because How do you think the Pharisees felt about that? Oh, man, they hated the Sadducees, and they despised what went on at the temple. And so you can bet the Pharisees were wildly excited about this crazy Nazarene and the way he showed the Sadducees what for, if you don't mind. Now, here's the dynamic that's a little bit esoteric or a little technical, but you need to understand it. As soon as Jesus became the wildly popular folk hero of the masses and thus tied the hands of his Jewish enemies, in this case the Sadducees, he left his Jewish enemies with one strategy if they wanted to be rid of him. They had to get the Romans to do their dirty work. And the only way to get Rome to move against Jesus was for the Sanhedrin to appeal to the Roman authorities. That make sense to you? But the Sanhedrin was almost evenly divided between Sadducee and Pharisee. You see what's going on here? Honest to goodness. Jesus catapults himself into notoriety. He angers the Sadducees but delights the Pharisees. So now the Sadducees are going to be frustrated because the Pharisees are not going to cooperate in any attempt to get the use the Sanhedrin to get the Romans to move against Jesus. Does that make sense to you? Are you with me? Now think about it. He cleanses the temple at his first Passover, but he just plugs his nose for the next two. But at the fourth Passover, right here, Monday morning of the Passion Week, he cleanses the temple a second time. Now, by the way, I need to say that Jesus angered the Sadducees early on and delighted the Pharisees. But then for the next 2.5 or 3 years, what's Jesus doing? He's going from synagogue to synagogue. Now whose turf is he on? And the Pharisees are mad. And you can watch it happen in the Gospels. They're getting more and more angry with Jesus. Now, this is conjecture, but I imagine that those Pharisees were going back to their Sadducean brethren and saying, you were right about this guy. We need to be rid of him. But the Sadducees are saying, hey, he's not bothering us. When it was our ox being gored, you were nowhere to be found. But on Monday morning, folks, get this, on Monday morning, Jesus cleanses the temple a second time. He deliberately galvanizes the anger of the Sadducees and the Pharisees. The Pharisees have been mad for a good long while. Now the Sadducees are beside themselves. I always say, imagine if the government, because the government sometimes just does whatever it feels like, if the government were to announce that this year all retail stores had to close down the day after Thanksgiving, couldn't open until January 5th or something. You think that's what's going on here, folks? For Jesus to shut down that income stream for a couple of days, for Jesus to put an end to all of that thievery and chicanery for 2 days, oh, the Sadducees are purple with rage. The Pharisees have been mad a long while. Now the Sadducees are just as mad. And that's why, as I say, on Tuesday night, they get together and say, we gotta kill him. The chief priests and the scribes, those are the Pharisees, get together and say, we gotta kill him, but not during the feast, and along comes Judas. And it is a measure of the insane degree of hatred and anger that they did, in fact, contrive to make this happen while the city was swollen to several hundred times its normal size by reason of all these Passover pilgrims. They're going home tomorrow. They're going home Sunday morning. Why not just wait? But no, they've got, because of Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. Sunday, the triumphal entry, which would have primarily, I think, angered the Pharisees, because it was the Pharisees who had put a price on his head and said he's to be arrested. And now he rides in, the whole city welcomes him as king. But then on Monday, he cleanses the temple a second time and, as I say, galvanizes the anger of the Sadducees and the Pharisees. And now it's going to take him 5 days to get him on the cross. That make sense to you? Folks, what I'm saying to you is this is not accidental. This is not just some random series of events. Jesus is, I think, deliberately, this is very, very deliberate. All right. So on Monday morning, he cleanses the temple, and then he possesses it for 2 days. Now, in the course of those 2 days, Jesus, I like to say that he behaved more messianically than any other time in his ministry. The Bible says explicitly, Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, that the messenger of the covenant, it's the title of the Messiah, will come suddenly to his temple. Ezekiel has him ruling in the temple. Everybody knew that the Messiah would rule from the temple. For 2 days, Jesus takes control of the temple. Mark says that he would not so much as allow a man to carry a vessel of water across the precincts of the temple. So how it looked, I don't know, if he positioned his disciples in various places, but he took over the temple. And he took on all of his comers. You know, this is where his enemies send representatives to ask him a question, to catch him in his words. You remember this? And, I tell people, if you, honest to goodness, if you gave me one free ride on your newly invented time machine, and with a limit of a couple of days, I would dial up Monday and Tuesday. These are staggeringly exciting days. It's just amazing. But I haven't got time to talk to you much about it. Just suffice it to say, as I say, that Jesus, in our culture, I always say, in our culture, if you want to prove you're a real man, what do? Well, maybe you beat everybody in the room in arm wrestling or whatever in the world. In a Jewish culture, you want to prove that you're a real man, a man to be respected above all other men, you put your enemy to silence in open debate. I can't say how stunning this is. And here is Jesus teaching in those vast courtyards and thousands of people hanging on every word, and his enemies are just beside themselves with anger now. It's Tuesday morning, and first of all, the Sadducees come. And let me tell you, the Sadducees come, and they say, I'll just walk through this real quickly, but you'll remember this. They say, tell us, by what authority do you do these things? Folks, there's more going on here than that. You got to understand it in its context very carefully. The fact is, I got to tell you, I mentioned to you earlier, and it's very, very important, I stressed it, that everywhere Jesus went, he claimed to be the Christ, the Son of the living God. But I also mentioned to you that Rome had absolutely no patience for pretender kings. And the word Messiah, though, as I say, it kind of wraps up all that the Old Testament said to the Jewish mind, and legitimately so, above all other things, Messiah is a king. And when he comes, he establishes a kingdom. Now, again, I'm going to say it. Rome, it was a fairly new empire. There were all of these peoples throughout the Roman Empire who could remember what it was to be running their own affairs and minting their own coins and collecting their own taxes and having their own standing army. Now they're under the heavy heel of Rome, which is not easy. Remember Daniel 7, the fourth beast? Remember this? The Babylon is the first beast. It's a lion. Medo-Persia is the second. It's a bear. Do you remember this? Greece is the third. It's a leopard. Rome is the fourth. What is it? But it's a monster. It's got these feet of clay, but on the other hand, it's got the great iron jaws with which it devours its enemies and great iron claws with which it tears it to shreds. That's Rome. Now, my point is that here you have this far-flung Roman Empire and this way, way stretched beyond its limit Roman army, and in this or that corner of the empire, now and again, a people would do a little political calculus and say, I think Rome is too distracted. We could have our independence back, and somebody would rise up, and he would proclaim himself king, and he would put together an army, and Rome couldn't tolerate it. They would not tolerate it. And so the point being that I come way back to it, Jesus makes the claim to be Messiah king, but he knows that that's a horribly incendiary claim. So here's where I'm taking you. Should just cut to the chase here. Jesus is really circumspect. He's really clever. And he's careful never to use the word Messiah of himself. Now, the reason is because he knows it will arm his enemies. So what he does, because he's so clever, and he does it right here, What he does is he takes to himself all sorts of Old Testament word pictures and passages and so on, which the Jewish ear will understand he's claiming to be Messiah, but he doesn't use the term. Honest to goodness, this is why, and we're going to talk about it in just a little bit, when they have that trial, that Jewish trial on Friday morning, they can't find any witnesses who will say, I heard him say he was Messiah, because he was so careful. Does that make sense to you? Do you know the one time he does take the title to himself during his public ministry? It's John 4, when the woman at the well says, I know that the Jews are looking for Messiah. And he says, the one speaking to you is he. But that's the only time he actually takes the title to himself until he's with his disciples there at Caesarea Philippi. But he makes claim. Now, the point is that this is what's behind the Sadducees' question. On the one hand, the Sadducees control the temple, and Jesus has taken that control from them. It's a horrible embarrassment and a financial hit, but they come to him and they say, tell us, by what authority do you do these things? Now, you got to understand that what they're hoping, what they're anticipating that he'll say is, I am your Messiah, and therefore I have a right to the temple. Because if he says that, they're going to go straight to Pontius Pilate, and they're going to say, this guy is standing on the temple, claiming to be a king, claiming to be Messiah. This is Passover. You got to do something about it. You got insurrection going on here. That's exactly the plan. And Jesus knows it. So Jesus says, this is playing by the rules. This is rabbinical reasoning. He said, all right, I'll ask you a question. The baptism of John, was it of heaven or was it of men? Now, folks, there is just bottomless rhetorical genius in that. It sounds like a totally non sequitur question. It's not, because those Sadducees stood off to the side and they said, now, wait a minute. If we say that the baptism of John was of heaven, then we got our answer, because John said he's the Messiah, and if he's the Messiah, he's got a right to the temple. But if we say that the baptism of John was not of heaven, these people will stone us because they love John the Baptist. Remember that? So now the Sadducees go back and they say, Master, we have no answer. Folks, a gasp would have gone up. There would have been cheers and huzzas. And this is a major knockout. And then, of course, the Pharisees come with the paying tribute to Caesar and give to, you know, the answer of Jesus, of course, is honor, give God the honor he's due and Caesar the honor he's due. And they've said, you've answered well. And then the Sadducees come again with the woman with the seven husbands story. Remember all that? But in every case, Jesus silences them entirely. And you have this remarkable verse in Luke 20, verse 40, where after that third of those three interchanges, Luke says that after that, no man dared ask him any question at all. In other words, they had enough of this sport. I'm telling you, this is heavyweight stuff, and Jesus absolutely vanquishes them again and again. But then Jesus does some other teaching. But what I want you to see is in Matthew 23. This is, now, I've, again, in an attempt just to summarize these days, Monday and Tuesday, I've taken you through somewhat happened, but I want you to see in Matthew 23, because I'm back to the question, don't worry about the overhead, just, here's the thing, in those, matter of fact, let's do it, I want you to see something, this is so big, folks, and these spiritual dynamics jump off the page at you, but you got to be conscious of them. Go back, if you will, to page 1, and I give you those 10 points and insights, I call them a little arrogantly, but I want you to see the sixth one. And folks, this is really important. All throughout his ministry, Jesus employed a remarkable and effective strategy. Now, hear me. We're going to take a break in just a minute. I know I'm wearing you out, but Jesus employed a remarkable strategy to test the willingness of people who insisted that they were anxious to follow him, to test their whether they were really willing to bow the knee to him. And I say it this way, number 6 there, throughout his ministry, Jesus employed a remarkable strategy to unmask the superficial and hypocritical nature of the public adulation paid him by the multitudes. Now, again, this is what I think consistently deceived his own apostles and disciples, because he's got these huge crowds, and that certainly looks good. But in point of fact, their fellowship was superficial, hypocritical, and entirely self-serving. And he's going to unmask it, and this is what he would do. I say, when confronted by shallow pseudo offers, if you know what I mean, it seems like they're willing to follow him, of acceptance, he would speak hard words. Now, I don't mean words that are intellectually difficult. I mean words which are going to cost you something to obey. Does that make sense to you? Now, folks, this is Jesus. I can take you. This is the rich young ruler. Do you get to heaven by selling everything you own? No, that's not the point. This man comes to him. Jesus claims to be Messiah King. This man says, I want to follow you. I want to be part of your kingdom. I want to give you my allegiance. All right. Jesus knows his heart. I don't think it takes omniscience. He can look at the man, see by the way he carries himself, the way he dresses and so on, what's important to him. So what does he do? And Jesus is a master at this. He puts his finger, Jesus does, if you don't mind, metaphorically, right on the most raw, sensitive, spiritual nerve in that man's body. And he says, all right, this is what I want you to do. Sell everything. Now, that's not how you get to heaven. That's foolish. But what he is doing, he is testing the willingness of this man to bow the knee to Jesus. Does that make sense to you? Now, here's the thing. He does it again and again. In Luke chapter 4, it's really stunning. I haven't got time to, but he grew up in Nazareth. And he knew, I'm talking about the time where Jesus goes back to the village, to Nazareth and goes back to the synagogue where he was reared, and he's invited to read the Isaiah scroll. Remember this? Marvelous time. And he reads the Isaiah scroll, and everybody's so amazed. He says, this day, here's another place where Jesus is careful. He doesn't say, I am Messiah. What he says is, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ear. So everybody in the room knows he's claiming to be Messiah. And it says that everybody looked at him. They were so amazed. And then what did Jesus say next? It's stunning. It seems like it's a total non sequitur. It's not. Jesus says, you know what? There were a lot of widows in Israel. There were a lot of Jewish widows in Elijah's day, but Elijah went to a Syrophoenician widow. And there were a lot of lepers in Elisha's day, but Naaman went to a Syrian, or ministered to a Syrian leper. And what happened next? They tried to throw him over a cliff. Where'd that come from? You see what he was doing? Jesus grew up in the city of Nazareth. Nazareth is on a ridge that dominates the Jezreel Valley, the important crossroads of international traffic. The Romans had put a battalion of Roman soldiers up there, and they lived right down the road from Nazareth. And they were thugs. The soldiers were thugs and barbarians and drunk half the time, and it was very dangerous. So the Nazarenes, the people of Nazareth, Jesus grew up there. He knew they hated the Gentiles. It's wrong. It's wrong to hate the Gentiles. So he makes the claim to be Messiah. They're all amazed, and he simply says, are you willing to bow the knee to this, that God loves the Gentiles, right off the edge of a cliff? Does that make sense to you? Folks, this is Jesus. He does it again. And I'm going to tell you something. He had a remarkably effective foil to make this case, and that's the Pharisees. Now, let's just talk about the Pharisees. We're going to take a break here in just a minute. But the Pharisees, number one, they were professional law keepers. That's what they did. They didn't work. They didn't have employ. They lived on the alms of the people, because their job was to every day study not really the Mosaic law, but the traditions about the law, and see if they could find a way that they could be more punctilious about obeying the law than anybody ever had before. They did it publicly, and to the Jewish mind. This is huge, because we read about the Pharisees, you know, blowing a trumpet and having people watch as they gave their alms. We thought, oh, how disgusting is that? What's going on? No. Just understand this, that to the Jewish mind, those Pharisees were doing this on behalf of the nation. God had given us this law. We got a workaday world. We got to be busy in the fields and the docks and whatever and so on. But there's this small group of men who give themselves to doing nothing but keeping the law. And certainly that must please God, and that must enhance our standing as a people. So the Pharisees were absolutely revered, but they taught that the way to please God was to keep the law. They talked a lot about God's grace, and much of is made of this today. They understood grace. They talked about, you bet they talked about grace, and they taught that God was so gracious that he gave us the law. And all we have to do is keep the law, and we'll be assured of the kingdom. Well, that's a soul-damning heresy. And Jesus came specifically to confront that heresy. But now I said to you before that the Pharisees were not only revered, but they were feared. Why? Because they ran the synagogue. And if you made them angry, they could put you apo synagoge. They could put you out of the synagogue. And that was a horrible, horrible fate. You were probably going to have to move to a different village. Your life was going to be totally upside down. So on the one hand, the Pharisees were revered as this epitome of faithfulness to the law, and they were respected, and the Pharisees and the scribes and basically most of the rabbis were all of a piece. So here's where I'm taking you. Jesus had ready to hand this Pharisaic fraternity, and when he wanted to test the willingness of the people to follow him, he could simply say, you choose between me and the Pharisees. Now, folks, this is exactly what he does in the Sermon on the Mount. I haven't got time to develop the Sermon on the Mount over much, but suffice it to say that the key verse, and almost everybody acknowledges the Sermon on the Mount, is Matthew 5 and verse 20, where Jesus says, and just imagine, as a matter of fact, I'm going to make the case that there is a remarkable parallel between Matthew 5 to 7, the Sermon on the Mount, and Matthew 23, where I'm taking you right now. What happens on Tuesday afternoon is the last time Jesus speaks publicly, he pronounces a series of excoriating woes on the Pharisees. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You compass land and sea to find one proselyte, and when you find him, you make him twofold more the child of hell than he was in the first place. These are hard words that he speaks. Why? Why does he do it? All right, stay with me. Let me say that it's a remarkably parallel. We have this pattern in the Sermon on the Mount. Now, and I like to say, if you're going to understand the Sermon on the Mount or Matthew 23, picture Jesus pointing. That is, I think over here in the corner is a gaggle of Pharisees, like I see, you can see them a mile off, and they're on the Sermon on the Mount. You have these thousands of people, many of them who were healed that morning, and Jesus goes up because they're like sheep who refuse their shepherd, and he stands there and he says, and I think pointing at the Pharisees. I'm making that up, but I just think it makes it the more dramatic. I imagine him pointing at the Pharisees and saying, unless your righteousness exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees, you'll never enter the kingdom of God. A gasp would have gone up. The Pharisees, Edersheim says that one of the ways in which the Pharisees love to refer to themselves, one of their nicknames for themselves is gatekeepers. And they would say, good morning, fellow gatekeeper. Because not only are we certain to get into the kingdom, but we know the law so well that God will allow us to decide who else gets into the kingdom. And now Jesus says, unless your righteousness exceed that of those scribes and Pharisees, and then the whole rest of the picture, they say unto you, I say unto you. You've heard it said from old, I say unto you. And at the end of the sermon, again, picture him pointing. I think he points at the Pharisees perhaps and says, there's a broad way. It leads straight to destruction. Help yourself. Or there's a narrow way. You can build your house on the sand, but it's going down. Or you can build your house on rock. Now, we know that this was Jesus' rhetorical habit to demand that people make a choice. So I'm back to it. Given Sunday, why Friday? And I believe the answer is Monday and Tuesday. Because on Monday and Tuesday, Jesus asserted his messianic identity and authority more dramatically than any other time in his ministry as he cleansed and possessed the temple and put to silence all of his enemies and built the case for his messiahship out of the Old Testament and so on. But the last discourse, the last thing Jesus has to say as he leaves the city is he pronounces these woes in Matthew 23. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees. You're like so many whited sepulchers. You look good. You know, by the way, the rabbis had made a decree that at Passover season, because so many people were going up to the temple, you had to put lime on the outside of your tombs, because most of the time your tomb would just be somewhere in the back 40 and it might get overgrown if you haven't used it for some time, and somebody just innocently going up to Passover, go over and sit in the shade, and you come along and say, hey, I tell you, you're leaning up against granddaddy's tomb and now you're impure and you can't even go to Passover and so on. So the rabbis had said, you gotta just take some lime and splash it on the outside. So here they are dotting the hillside, and they look kind of nice, gleaming in the sunshine. Jesus, I picture him, Jesus is saying, you're like so many whited sepulchers. You look good, but men just brush up against you, and they become a stench in God's nostrils. Anytime in the Old Testament, anytime in the Bible, you read about impure, where you know, something, think of it, because I think this is the picture behind it. It makes you stink. Spiritually, it makes you stink. You don't like people around you who stink, and God doesn't either. And you become stinky when you're unclean, when you're impure. And that's what Jesus is saying. You're like so many whited sepulchers. People just rush up against you, and they become a stench in God's nostrils. On and on. Woe unto you. And here's the, now, here's what I'm saying. Given Sunday, why Friday? And I think it's because Jesus on Monday and Tuesday used the same strategy that he used again and again. And that is, he spoke hard words. And he said, all right, it's an easy thing for me to ride into town. You throw your garments down and you say, be our deliverer. But, and here's the rub. Now get this. Here's the real rub. I am convinced that when the common Jewish, when all of those Jewish pilgrims who had come up for Passover that year were so excited to welcome Jesus, and they cry out, as the Bible commands, Hoshana, Hosanna, be our Savior. What they meant was, be our Savior from Rome. Because in point of fact, they knew that they couldn't deliver themselves from Rome. But Jesus insists that you understand, you accept him as the Messiah of the Old Testament, which means most fundamentally and most seminally, the Savior from sin. But they weren't interested in that because they were convinced, the Pharisees taught them, that they had that taken care of. They could save themselves from sin. That's what the law is for. That make sense to you? And so what's going on? I like to say it this way. Sunday, Jesus rides into the city of Jerusalem and offers himself as Messiah, as deliverer, as the long-awaited Savior, first promised in Genesis 3. And he's fully qualified to do it, and he offers himself as Savior even today. On Monday and Tuesday, Jesus cleanses the temple, behaves messianically, and then as he leaves the city, he says, look, you make a choice. It's either the Pharisees or me. It's not going to be both. You choose between that wicked gospel of self-righteousness through keeping the law. You choose between that and simply depending upon what God has promised, and that's me. So I like to say, if on Sunday Jesus makes the case that he is the long-awaited Messiah deliverer, on Monday and Tuesday, Jesus makes this case. You don't take Jesus on your terms. You take him on his terms. And his terms are that he is your only hope. He is the promised deliverer. Does that make sense to you? Now, I think Jesus on Tuesday afternoon, very deliberately forced that city to a decision. It's me or the Pharisees. And they're going to have about 3 days to think about that. And very early on Friday morning, to their shock and surprise, the news is going to begin to spread like wildfire through that swollen city, swollen in size, that this Nazarene, whom they welcomed as king on Sunday and whom they applauded as he took possession of the temple on Monday and Tuesday, that Nazarene is on trial for his life on the western side of the city, and they're going to make their way there, and Pilate's going to put a question to him. We'll talk about it after the break. Pilate's going to say, who would you have me give you, Barabbas or Jesus? And to Pilate's shock and surprise, and because the Bible says in Matthew, the chief priests persuaded the people, they said, give us Barabbas. And when they did, they announced their verdict. Does Does that make sense to you? If on Tuesday afternoon Jesus is saying, you choose, it's me or the Pharisees. On Friday morning, they announce the verdict. Does that make sense to you? So given Sunday, why Friday? I think the answer is Monday and Tuesday, and I think it's very deliberate, and it's the rhetorical strategy Jesus uses again and again to speak hard words, usually contrasting himself to the Pharisees, and the city chooses the Pharisees. Does that make sense to you? It would have cost him dearly to make the other choice. All right, let's take a break. Let me say this. We already talked about Tuesday night. Actually, as Jesus leaves the city of Jerusalem on Tuesday afternoon, for the last time under his own power, he's going to be dragged out of the city to crucifixion later on. But as he leaves the city for the last time, on the way out of town, he stands on the Mount of Olives, and his disciples are amazed at Herod's temple, and he preaches the Olivet Discourse of Matthew 24 and 25. That's Tuesday afternoon as he's going back to Bethany. He goes back to Bethany, and it's there on Tuesday night as I think he's there. By the way, Judas was the only Judean of the 12. The others were all Galileans, so they're far from home. The Galileans, of course, are the blue-collar, dirt-under-the-fingernail fishermen, laborers, and so on. The Judeans are the sophisticates and the white-collars and the educated and so on. Judas was very, very much respected. He was given the responsibility of keeping the bag and so on, the common treasury. But he was the only one who actually lived down there in Judea. So you can imagine, it's Passover season. It wouldn't be hard on Tuesday night for him to say, you know what, I got to go visit the family or whatever. So Judas leaves and makes his way down to that hill of evil counsel. Remember we talked about it? By the way, does God have a sense of humor? Do you know what sits on the hill of evil counsel today? It's always fun. You know, it's kind of dramatic. You look south from Jerusalem, here's this big hill, and up there's this big building. It's the UN building. You do what you want with that. But the fact of the matter is that... that's not why it's called the Hill of Evil Counsel. It's the Hill of Evil Counsel because that's where Judas went, to the home, the personal home of Caiaphas. And on Tuesday night, now get this, we're going to pick it up right here after the break. On Tuesday night, a plot is laid in place. And that plot is totally dependent upon Judas's capacity to help the Sanhedrinists arrest Jesus in the absence of the multitude. Remember that? And they're not just shooting at stars here. They know the next time Jesus will be in the absence of the multitude is at the Passover feast, because you have to be indoors, no more than 20, no fewer than 10 on each lamb and so on. So this whole plot, and it's only laid in place. It only is conceived. Remember, when Judas went there, they were throwing their hands in the air, saying, we got to kill him, but not during the feast. There'll be a riot. Along comes Judas, says, I can help you. Ah, we can make this happen. And so a plot is laid to get Jesus, watch this, arrested, tried, sentenced, and on his way to execution, here's the rub, while the city sleeps. That's the whole plot. Why? Because they got Sunday, Monday, Tuesday ringing in their ears. And they don't want, neither the Jews or the Romans want a riot. And this is as difficult a situation you can imagine. So this whole plot is about getting Jesus arrested, tried, sentenced on his way while the city sleeps. Does that make sense to you? And it's laid because Judas makes it possible. All right, we'll pick it up there after the break. All right, let's take a break for 15 minutes, and I'll see you at the top of the hour. That's 11 o'clock, but... Okay, folks, if I can ask you to come on back now, I know it's going to be a hard, long morning, but a lot of stuff to cover. And this is what I'd like to do. What are you going to argue? I'm just going to keep going. We won't take another formal break, but you get up and move about as you need to, all right? Because I really need to get us to the place where tomorrow morning during the worship service we can contemplate the actual crucifixion and resurrection. But let me pick it up. Again, this is the outline that I've used Sunday, a day of messianic presentation, and that's the triumphal entry. And you know what? Let me do this. All right. This is a weird place to do it, but I don't want to break the narrative. This outline that I'm using here and the way I'm configuring the events of this week is entirely standard. This is not anything aberrational or unusual about the actual calendar of events. On the other hand, you know that there is a good deal of debate as to on what day Jesus died. I'm not really assuming, but this proceeds on the persuasion that he died on Friday. Let me just talk about the issue real quickly, and if you'll go to page 2019, I give you in your notes a chart. And the chart is designed to contemplate the various theories as to the day of the week that Jesus died. And there are those who believe Wednesday, and there are those who believe Thursday. I am arguing for Friday. Now, let's just cut to the chase. And if this is, let me just say this, that if this is something about which you feel strongly and you disagree with Friday, I'd ask you to just be patient with me. It'll work no matter what day. This is entirely an intramural. This is not a function of any sort of heresy or anything like that. But it's, and I'll just say this, that every indication, and there's strong, compelling indications in the record, is that Jesus died on Friday. But there is a problem. What's the problem? That's the issue, and it's a real issue. It's an issue for me just as much as it is for you. 3 days and three nights. How can we say that Jesus was in the tomb for 3 days and three nights? Because he says three different times that as Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights, so the Son of Man will be in the heart of the earth for 3 days and three nights. What are we going to do with that? All right, number one, let me just say, and this is important to get on the record, that where you do have that three times, 42 times in the record, the reference is the third day. Jesus says, on the third day I will rise again. Those disciples on the road to Emmaus when they encountered Jesus on the morning of his resurrection, don't you know that this is the third day since he died? Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15 that he rose again on the third day. So 42 times you have the third day. Now, the Bible is inerrant, right? There are no mistakes in the Bible. So clearly the third day is absolutely synonymous with 3 days and three nights. They got to be, because they both describe, they both define the amount of Jesus' period in the grave. So how are we going to reconcile this? Well, I think, and if you look on page 20 toward the bottom, under letter D, I give you a quote, and this is where I'm defending or analyzing this whole idea of Jesus dying on Friday. And by the way, can I tell you this, that the Jews do not name the days of the week except for one. They number them. So Sunday, what we call Sunday is the first day of the week, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day. But the Friday is called the day of preparation. And then you have the seventh day. So the sixth day is the day of preparation. Sabbath means seven. That's what the word means. So because the day of preparation... It's if you've been around Jewish folk at all, you know that Friday afternoon is given to preparing for the Sabbath. They can't Orthodox Jews, careful Jews, they won't turn on any lights. So any lights you want to have on in the house on Saturday, you got to turn on Friday. Won't cook any food, so you got to cook all the food on Friday and have everything in readiness and so on. Well, and again, that the day of Jesus' crucifixion is called the day of preparation, which is another way of saying Friday. Now, we're still left with the problem, how then can it be said that he was in the tomb 3 days and three nights? Well, in letter D there, I cite a statement by a Jewish rabbi from about 100 AD, so very contemporary to Jesus, and let me say, this rabbi is not talking about the gospel. He's not explaining what the gospelists mean. He's just talking about the way the Jewish people use the language. And he says, do you see it there? Rabbi Eliezer ben Azariah, He says, a day and night are an ona. Now, ona means a unit. It's all one. It's just one portion, one unit, a portion of time. And then he says this, the portion of an ona is as the whole of it. Now, hear what he's saying, that in the Jewish nomenclature, and folks, this is, again, and I don't mean to grab ground that I don't deserve, but it's so important to read the Bible in terms of its own culture, and there are so many ways in which the language is framed in ways that are slightly foreign to us. In our Western, modern, kind of precise, scientific way of thinking, we think of 3 days and three nights as 72 hours. That's got to be 72 hours. Well, what they're saying is three-day nights. And any portion of a day night is as the portion of a day, any portion is as the day night. So if he's in the grave before the sun goes down on Friday, that's a day night. That makes sense to you? Then all day Saturday, and then Sunday morning, he rises sometime after around sunup. But the fact is that he's been in the grave a portion of three day night onas. That makes sense to you? I think it's the best way to deal with it. And so now again, and I'll say one other thing, too, just quickly, and that is, it is interesting, and I think timely and instructive, that as I said to you before, in respect, when we were talking about Lazarus, that the Jewish protocol was that you could attend to a body for 3 days. The day he died was the first day, then a second day, then a third day, and as the sun went down, on the third day, you sealed the tomb because the body is going to begin to stink unbearably. Well, what were those women going to do on Sunday morning? Do you see the point? They were going to finish the burial. Now, Jesus died on Friday. That's day one. Saturday's day two. That would be legitimate. See the point? If he dies on Thursday, that tomb would have been sealed on Saturday night. So I think it's an important consideration. But I'm going to say again, having seized the high ground, and I'm the only guy in the room with a microphone, I know, so... I've thought it through pretty carefully. I realize that there are careful arguments made for other days, but we're going to work. And that's so. I say it just because here you have the whole week in front of you, and Friday, the day of messianic perfection, when Jesus announces it is finished, as we'll talk about on Sunday morning, as that's the day of crucifixion. All right, let me go back to it then. So we said Sunday is a day of messianic presentation, the triumphal entry. Jesus made that happen in fulfillment of Old Testament prophecies, which demanded that it happen, and I think even happened on that day. But then we asked the question, given Sunday, why Friday? I think the answer is Sunday and Monday and Tuesday, where Jesus behaves so messianically and then drives the city to a decision, as we talked about. On Tuesday night, Jesus went back to Bethany. Wednesday is a silent day. Now, let me just say that some are off-put by that, but in point of fact, I think it's a very important day because think about this, just real quickly. This is just kind of a historical point, but it means something to me. The fact is that the plot, which was only hatched on Tuesday night, that's so important. You've got to understand, Matthew 26 and Mark 14 are explicit. Yeah, well, Luke 22 says it as well, that on Tuesday night, the Sanhedrinists were throwing their hands in the air and saying, not during the feast. We can't get it done during the feast. There'll be a riot. But along comes Judas late on Tuesday night and say, oh, we can make this happen. So it's only on Tuesday night that they begin to lay in place this plot to get Jesus arrested and tried and so on. But as the plot unfolds, it's huge, because this is what's going to happen. On Thursday night, when Judas reveals the place, we'll talk about it in just a minute, he's going to go and fetch 600 soldiers. Now that's, and that's undoubtedly a rough number. It's not precise. And actually, all right, John 18 says that Judas came with a cohort. And a cohort is a formal military term. And it means a battalion of about 600 men. Now that includes some horsemen, some cavalry. It includes some support wagons and so on. But he come, and it says this, that he came with a cohort armed with armor, weapons, and lanterns. And a lot of critics say, oh, that's silly. Jesus had no military force. Why would, no, that's nothing to do with Jesus. They are afraid of a riot. You've got to understand. And just imagine, by the way, now my point is simply this, that all of the logistical demands as it unfolds would suggest that there we need a day to get this all in place. That makes sense to you? It only begins late on Tuesday night, and the trap is going to be sprung on Thursday. And I think Wednesday, although it's silent, in other words, the record jumps from late Tuesday until Thursday afternoon when Jesus sets out to keep the Passover. That's where we're going to be in just a moment. But the fact is that I think the day Wednesday was given to a lot of scurrying about as the Sanhedrinists approached Pilate. And see, you don't just knock on the door of the Fortress Antonia, the fortification there in Jerusalem, and say, quick, I need 600 soldiers, right? This is going to be orders. And you got to understand, the order that came down was, we are going to arrest a seditionist. And let me tell you something. Rome had some significant experience with Jewish seditionists. And it was always ugly. I like to say, and this is my own kind of construct, but I like to say that the three basic rules that you had to live with if you're a Roman province, if you're a people under the Roman, here are the three rules you got to live by. Number one, you don't raise your hand against Rome. But number two, if you do, we are going to put it down. Rome is going to put it down within hours, maybe days, but they are going to bring such overwhelming force. They are going to squash it so quickly, they don't want anybody else to be encouraged that maybe this will work. Does that make sense to you? So number one, you don't raise your hand. Number two, if you do, we're going to put it down in hours, probably, maybe days. And number three, the blood will run for months. You're going to pay so dearly for this. And villages in the region are going to be squashed and slaughtered and people taken off to slavery and the games and so on. Now, I say that just to make this point that the one place in the Roman world where it didn't work was Israel. Because they would mount a sedition and the Romans would bring a little force and it would be, you know, I like to say, the land of Israel is like one big paintball arcade. Do we still work with paintball? You know what I'm saying? It's just made for guerrilla warfare. And Rome knows nothing but overwhelming force. And it doesn't work. It never worked. And the Jews would resist, and what should they thought were going to be able to put down in days would go on for 2 or 3 years. It happened again and again. So the point is, when the word comes down early on a Wednesday, sometime on Wednesday, that we need to prepare ourselves because tomorrow we're going, and this is Passover. The city is abuzz with seditious talk. I mean, at least the Jewish hearts are beating with hopes of sedition, and the Romans know it. So the point is that number one, you have a whole cohort of soldiers who have to be put on the alert and make preparation and put on their armor and their weapons and so on. It's a huge effort. Does that make sense to you? But then what happens is, Jesus is, in fact, we'll talk about it, going to be arrested, and he's going to be taken and tried before the Jewish authorities, before the Sanhedrin, in the middle of the night. Now, this is a culture where, A, when the sun goes down, you go down. You don't do things at night. Artificial life is very sparse, very expensive. You live by the sunlight. And so to have this kind of effort, and number two, it's a time where you can't get a message from here to there any faster than you can get a human being from here to there, right? So you got these 70 Sanhedrinists living all around the territory, wealthy and so on, but you got to send people out, alert them that we've got them and so on. You can't just send out an email, you know what I'm saying? So number one, you got 600 soldiers. Number two, you've got 70 Sanhedrinists who are going to convene in the on the Western Hill in Jerusalem in the home, the priestly villa of Caiaphas in the middle of the night. But then the big one is, number three, after the Jewish authorities induce Jesus to admit he is Messiah, we'll talk about it, then Jesus is going to be taken to Pilate. And about 4:30 in the morning. And because the Jews do not want to defile themselves to go into a Gentile household, remember this, John 18:28, therefore they induce, and you can bet some drachma change hands here, because they induce Pilate to bring his whole official judicial apparatus about 4:30 in the morning to outside the praetorium because they don't want to go inside. Now, do you hear where I'm taking you? Wednesday is a silent day, but I think it was a busy day because the plot only is conceived on Tuesday night. We know that explicitly, and it's going to be sprung on Thursday evening. And I think Tuesday it would have been a busy day with a lot of scurrying about, making the arrangements for the soldiers, getting everything ready for the nocturnal Sanhedrin trial, and then bribing Pilate and persuading him to come out. He didn't want anything to do with this. But you can bet there was a lot of chicanery and leverage going on here. IOUs being clipped. So Pilate finally agrees to come out and have this trial outside the praetorium just after the first blush of dawn on Friday morning. All right, so that's Wednesday. Now, I'm going to suggest one other thing happened on Wednesday. Because on Thursday afternoon, Luke 22, go there real quickly, Luke 22 and verse 7, you'll remember that, and remember verse 6 says that Judas took money and consented to help them arrest him in the Jesus in the absence of the multitude. And then, and that's late Tuesday night, and then the record jumps to Thursday afternoon, and it says in verse 7, then came the day of unleavened bread when the Passover must be killed. So this is the day when the Passover lamb is to be killed. It's Nisan 14, and the Bible is explicit that the lamb is to be slain between the evenings. Now, in Jewish life, in Israel, you got to understand Israel lies between the desert and the sea. And in the summer, all their weather comes off the east, off the Arabian desert. It's pretty miserable. But the air heats up in the course of the day and begins to rise. And now you get these luscious Mediterranean breezes coming off the Mediterranean Sea about 3 in the afternoon. And when you get those afternoon breezes, that's the first evening. It seems awkward, and most translations put that the lamb has to be slain at twilight. But what the Hebrew actually says is between the evening, and between the evenings, because the first evening is when you get those breezes, and the last evening is when, the second evening, if you don't mind, is when the sun disappears beyond the horizon. So for about 4 hours, 3 o'clock to 7 o'clock or so in the spring is when the lamb has to be slain at the temple. So on Thursday afternoon, Jesus dispatches his disciples, Peter and John, and he sent Peter and John saying, go prepare the Passover that we may eat. What does that mean? Well, they're going to go into town, they're going to go get the lamb, wherever the lamb is. The lamb has to have been with them for about 4 days, so the lamb is probably right there in Bethany. They're staying every night in Bethany, and the Bible is explicit that you have to have the lamb inspected by the 10th of Nisan. And then the lamb has to be with you. You can't put him out in a pasture. You got to keep him like a pet. The lamb has to get used to you because you're going to take him into this horribly, horribly busy, cacophonous temple and stand over him as the priest slits his throat. He needs to learn to trust you to let him do that to you. So at any rate, so they would have taken the lamb and had it slain, and then they would have prepared the meal, a sort of a mash, and they would have gone to the place where they were going to keep the Passover and set everything up, but they didn't know where that was. So he says in verse 8, go and prepare the Passover, and they say to him, where do you want us to prepare? And you know this story. He said, behold, when you have entered the city, a man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him and into the house which he enters, and say to the master of the house, the teacher says, where is the guest room? And he will show you a large furnished upper room. All right, now, look, folks, be patient with me here. And I don't know why. This is just a place where I've had people get a little angry with me, and I'm such a nice guy. I don't have it coming. But honest to goodness, folks, honest, people, now just think about this. People intuitively, and I think mistakenly, take this to be omniscience. That Jesus somehow, like, forgive me, I don't mean to be flip here, but like Jesus said, go prepare. And they said, where do you want us to do that? And he said, well, I hadn't thought about that, but I'm getting some here. Go into town. You're going to find a man. Now, wait a minute here. Number one, what's that man doing there? What's that all about? I think Jesus set this up. That's another thing that I think was probably happened on, this is the way I envision it. Sometime on that Wednesday, it's silent day, nothing going on in town, no reason for them going to town. They just stay there in Bethany, quiet day, somewhere in the course of the day. And by the way, Judas is anxious to know where this Passover is going to be. But I picture Jesus going to one of Lazarus's servants, or maybe going to Lazarus and saying, I need to borrow a servant for a few minutes. all right, I got a little errand. So he goes over in the side of the courtyard and talks to this servant, says, I need you to go into town. There's a woman in town. Her name is Mary. Her son is Mark. She is very wealthy. She has a home high on the Western Hill in the most exclusive gated neighborhood in all of Jerusalem. It's a large house with a upper room specifically prepared for a feast. That means it's a very wealthy home. But, and this is more than I got time to talk about, but I think because she is a Judean Jew, she'll not celebrate the Passover that day, so I need to borrow her room. Ask her if we can use her upper room, and if so, have a man carrying a pitcher of water. A man carrying a pitcher of water is a really remarkably clever signal, because normally it would be a woman or a child. But on the other hand, it's not bizarre. People are not going to, it's not a two-headed chicken. You know, people aren't going to stop and stare, for heaven's sakes. But a man carrying a pitcher of water is a remarkable signal. And I think Jesus said, have that man there. Why? What's going on here, folks? This is Jesus being wise as a serpent. What is he doing? He's keeping the place secret from Judas. Because if Judas knew the place, he would have had the Sanhedrinists and the soldiers there. And we wouldn't have had either the upper room or the discourses or Gethsemane. And when Jesus does gather in the upper room with his disciples, you remember he tells them, you don't know with what fervent desire I have desired to keep this with you. And what I think he's saying in part is, I have rather moved heaven and earth to make sure that we would have this Passover season together, because he knows that Judas is laying in wait. And the bargain is that Jesus is going to be arrested in connection with the Passover. Now, two points to be made here real quickly. Number one, imagine how this impacts Judas. Think about Judas for a minute. Judas has 600 soldiers, 70 Sanhedrinists, and the entire judicial apparatus of Pontius Pilate waiting for this nocturnal trial. None of it can happen until he fulfills his part of the bargain, and Jesus has snookered him. Jesus has, so he doesn't know where it is. And that's why I say, I think he was probably anxious to know, but Jesus kept it from him. And that's why in the upper room, Judas is looking for an opportunity to get out now that he knows the place. That makes sense to you? So I'm persuaded that Jesus had carefully prepared for this final Passover in a way so that he had kept it secret from Judas. That's the point. Now, there's another point to be made here just quickly, and that is this. You got to think about this, how this must have impacted the apostles, the other 11. Well, really all of them. But you know, normally, you see, the city of Jerusalem would swell to several times its normal size at Passover. There was no place for most of those people to stay. The Bible is explicit that you had to have the sacrifice, you had to have the lamb sacrificed at the temple, then you had to take the meat and gather indoors. Now, most people would do this in tents. Tents were really, really common. Everybody had a tent. You lived a good deal in a tent and so on. And so all of the hills around Jerusalem would have just been totally, totally covered with people who had pitched a tent. And that would be their domicile while they were there for the feast. And they would go, and because you had to go indoors, remember that, with your feet, your shoes on, and keep the feast. And I think the apostles probably figured, that's what we'll do. We've been staying in Bethany, but we can't keep the feast here because it has to be within eyesight of the temple. So somewhere around Jerusalem. But now Jesus takes him across the city and up onto the Western Hill, the most exclusive, and then walks into, you know, there's probably an outdoor staircase that went up to this beautiful room that was furnished for a feast. My point is, I think most of the apostles very possibly had never been in a home this nice. And I think this just once again reinforced this notion of theirs that Jesus is about to hand out kingdom assignments. Several weeks earlier, Jesus had said to the 12, you 12 will sit on 12 thrones over the 12 tribes in the regeneration in the kingdom. And you know what? Some of those tribes are bigger than others. And I think they were jealous. They didn't want Dan or Gad, you know what I'm saying? They were looking for Judah or Ephraim. And so they're and again, with all of for several months, Jesus has been insisting, I'm going to die. What they know for sure is that as he rode into town, the whole city welcomed him as king. And then he had laid claim to the temple for 2 days and behaved like Messiah in a way that he never had before. And now comes Thursday afternoon, and he walks him up to a beautiful home with a large upper room. I think they're thinking, oh, we are on a roll here. It's coming together, and you have to understand that. So I want to take you to Thursday, which is a time of Thursday afternoon and evening of messianic preparation on two counts. First of all, Jesus in the upper room. I'm looking around here. Jesus in the upper room has, it's a time of preparation of his disciples. I like to say that Thursday is twice a time of preparation. First of all, in the upper room, Jesus prepares his disciples for what's about to happen. And then secondly, in the Garden of Gethsemane, obviously he prepares his own soul spirit. We'll talk about both those things very quickly. Let me take you first of all to the upper room. And I'd like to do something, and I should have set this up. But I'd like to ask a young person to help me. Would you come help me? Now, this is not a speaking part, okay? But you want to come up here? All right, tell me your name.
Evelyn.
Evelyn, good. Now, Evelyn is going to be the Apostle John, okay? And I am going to be Jesus. I took the major part, forgive me. But we're going to lay down on the floor, and I'll tell you why. It's a little shtick that I do. But when you think of the Last Supper, all right, now listen, let's make sure you understand. They gather for the Passover. They keep the Passover. After the Passover is finished, Jesus announces the betrayers at the table, and Judas ultimately gets up and leaves. Then Jesus begins to teach, and he introduces what we think of as the Lord's Supper. They gathered for the Passover. It was only after Judas left to fetch the Sanhedrin and the soldiers that he introduced what we think of as the Lord's Supper and commenced to teach. Now, when you think of the Last Supper, your mind goes rather spontaneously, does it not, to Da Vinci. And that may be good art, but that's really bad history. Can we all agree on this? So, I mean, I always say 13 guys on the far side of the table facing the artist, you know, listen, they're sitting on high chairs and so on, two to back chairs. The fact is that the Bible says explicitly that they reclined to eat. And the reason is because the Bible says again and again that this was a large upper room that was furnished for a feast. Now, I won't get into this, but I'll just tell you, this part, the upper city, the Western Hills. Matter of fact, I have a map here, and you have this map in your notes, but that Western Hill, as it's called, the upper city that catches the Mediterranean breezes, that's high and flat, and where the beautiful, beautiful villas, and where Herod had his beautiful palace, Herod the Great had constructed a palace on the west side of the city, and just south of that is where this woman would have had her beautiful villa home and so on. So the point is that up on that western hill is where Jesus takes his disciples for this. What I started to say is this. That part of the city, number one, was most trashed from 48 to 67 because it was the Jewish territory and it was just trashed. And then in 1967, there was a great deal of fighting there in the Six-Day War. So this part of the city was available to be dug. Does that make sense to you? It was just trashed. There weren't homes there. So it's more thoroughly dug than most of Jerusalem is hard to dig because there are people living there. But this was very, very accessible, and they dug it a great deal. And they found a number of these huge villas, and they found three of these upper rooms furnished, the remains of three upper rooms. They all featured what's called a triclinium, which is a three-sided or U-shaped table. And there are pillows on the outside. It's U-shaped so a servant can get in and serve from inside the tables. That makes sense to you? And you recline on the outside. So, Evelyn, here we go. Let's lay down on the floor here. This will take me some work to get back up, but I can do it. I can do it. Now, I want you to lay on your left elbow right here, just like this. No, you were right before. That's good. Now, you can get up and move around if you have to see this, but this is more. Now, here is the table. So you sit, however you're, there's a big pillow here. So you might sit Indian fashion, you might sit whatever, but there's a table right here. And there are little bowls with the meat, and everybody has an individual loaf of bread, and so you just tear it off and dip. And if you get a nice morsel, you might hand it to a friend, a neighbor, which would be just an act of kindness and fraternity and so on. So let's just kind of recalibrate the way we think of this scene, because again, this is John the Apostle, all right? Now, what kind of guy is John? He's a good guy, but we often think of him as kind of an effeminate guy. I don't know why. He's the youngest. Whenever you see pictures of the apostles, the only one without a beard will be John. I don't know why. But they, and they're trying. John, what's the nickname that Jesus gives him and his brother? Yeah, these are hard-driving dudes. You know, there are three times in the gospel records where we encounter James and John. One is when they're trying to get their mother to find them. By the way, this is the picture. One on the right, one on the left. Don't think of a throne room. When they're asking to sit one on the right, one on the left, the gospel, the feast, I'm sorry, the kingdom is a feast, and it's pictured because it kind of prefigures. But the point is that when James and John send their mother and ask for one on the right, one on the left, the other time is when they want to call fire down in a Samaritan village, and the other time is when they get mad at somebody for casting out demons who doesn't have a union card. Remember that? And Jesus says, come on, if you're not against it, he's for us, for heaven's sake. So everything about John would suggest that he's a pretty hard-driving dude. And it kind of leaves us with a bit of a question, because this is what unfolds. Now, let's just tell the story from here. Jesus, and the Bible says that as they entered the room, well, Luke 21 says, but I think it's as they entered the room, but it's kind of told in retrospect. But at any rate, sometime in the course of the feast, there arose a dispute among them as to who should be greatest in the kingdom. Now, folks, I'm going to say again, Jesus knows he'll never sleep again. He knows he's going to be arrested within a few hours and on a cross within a few more hours. His disciples are convinced that he's about to hand out kingdom assignment. And I think that probably what happened is the dispute arose over seating arrangement, because there is a designated spot where the captain of the feast, the one who's going to host and administer the feast, sits. And the closer you are to him, obviously, the greater your honor. And so everybody wants to sit. I think probably the dispute arose. They're all diving for the chief seats. And John is sitting here. Now, who's here? To my left, as it were, almost certainly is Judas, which is interesting. But remember now, Judas is much respected by the other apostles. So what happens is that, again, as the feast is in, they have the entire feast, and this is not a dinner, it's a feast. It features some food, but it's a feast, and it means it's a time of celebrating and remembering and so on. So we're remembering the Exodus, and we're telling the story and so on. And the feast is now ended, and Jesus announces, the hand of the betrayer is with me at the table. Now, this is a shock. And when he says that, everybody at the table begins to say, who could it be? Is it I? They all begin now. Matthew says explicitly, this is big, that Judas, who I am convinced was right next to Jesus, leaned over to Jesus and said, Master, is it I? And Jesus says, it is. So now all pretense is gone. Whatever he thought of subterfuge, Jesus says, I know exactly what you're doing. And that would have been a real spiritual crisis point for Judas. Am I going to go through with this? But then, now, this is John, this is Judas, Jesus is here. We can also orient kind of roughly Peter, because Peter evidently moved kind of slow, because when Jesus said, the hand of the betrayer is with me at the table, remember, Peter made motion to John, ask who it is. So John leans back. Now, you see, if he wants to whisper to me, see the point? And he just leans back, and he calls himself the disciple who leaned on Jesus' breast. That's more or less the formal way to designate that the person right next to Jesus. That makes sense to you? So John, leans back and asks, I think privately, who is it? And Jesus says to John, it's the one to whom I give the morsel. Now, curiously enough, it seems to me that John would have been very much on the lookout. And now some time goes by, and Jesus does what is just an act of fraternity, of kindness. You just take a morsel and hand it to your neighbor. And he does that to Judas. You know, I think the other guys at the table probably thought, oh, nuts, there went Judah. You know what I'm saying? I think they probably, oh, man. Give him Judah. But in point of fact, again, sin makes you stupid. And Judas is sitting there, boiling, realizing he's got 600 soldiers, 70 Sanhedrinists, and Pilate's judicial apparatus waiting for him to show up and tell him where this is. And when Jesus hands him the sop, Satan just uses that in his twisted soul spirit, and he's, I'm going through with it. So he makes an excuse, and he gets up and leaves. Now, the question arises, and it's a secondary question, and I don't know there's any special answer, but any specific answer, but it's the given who John is, you might expect him to be on the lookout and try and stop it. But I think, number one, he was probably totally, totally dumbstruck. And number two, I think Jesus is here to hold him down if he has to. Just leave it alone. You know what I'm saying? So Judas goes off to fetch the Sanhedrinists. Jesus begins to teach. And in the middle of his sermon, John 14, verse 31, suddenly he says, arise, let's go hence. Now, you got to understand, I'm convinced that these apostles probably fully anticipated that once the supper was entered, so they just lean back and go to sleep here, spend the night here. But Jesus all of a sudden says, arise. Why? You got to understand that Judas goes off to the Antonia. It's on the map there, just north of the Temple Mount, the northwest corner of the Temple Mount. And Judas would have gone up there to fetch the Sanhedrinists. Where would he have gone after that? He'd have gone back to the upper room. Jesus knows this, and he's trying to buy himself a little time. He's not trying to escape, but he is desperate for the time with his father in Gethsemane. So Jesus takes his disciples, John 14, 31, and makes his way across the darkened city down to that gate on the southern end of the city and down the Kidron Valley to a private hobby farm on the other side of the Kidron Valley, low on the Mount of Olives, called Gethsemane. There he prays. Judas would have come back, found the room empty, and here John, who is so deliberately supplementing the synoptics in places, John gives us a huge help when he says Judas also knew the place, Gethsemane, because Jesus often stayed there. And so Judas says, don't worry, guys, I know where he has to be, and takes the soldiers out to Gethsemane. Now, after that season of prayer, as Jesus emerges from the garden, here comes Judas and the Sanhedrinists, and Jesus is arrested late on Thursday. Does that make sense to you? Thank you, Evelyn. Thank you so much. All right, let me see if I can't stand back up here. On the first try, I can. Good deal. All right, now, let me walk you a little further through that. I want to take you to John chapter 12, and I wrote myself a reminder here, and I'm glad I remembered. Folks, listen. Thursday is, on two counts, a time of messianic preparation. It is, first of all, Jesus preparing his disciples through this marvelous series of discourses. John 14, let not your heart be troubled. And 15, I am the vine, you are the branches. And 16, it's expedient for you that I go away. If I don't go away, the Comforter will not come, the new covenant. But if I depart, he'll come to you, and so on. So, excuse me. Jesus is, and all of this is spoken either in the upper room or on the way out to Gethsemane. Then John 17, where Jesus prays for his disciples. And look at John 18 real quickly. I got you in John 12, but in John 18 and verse 1, John gives us, I think, a very, very poignant reference, because it says, then he stepped over the brook Kidron, leaving the city. You have that? He stepped over the brook Kidron. The brook Kidron drains the Kidron Valley. Interestingly enough, you know, when you think of the temple, we tend to think of it as a bit of a cathedral, even the pictures that I show you and so on, but you understand it was a slaughterhouse. And tens of thousands of animals slain there constantly, and that made a bit of a mess. And it all had to be maintained in good hygiene and so on. And so there were the Levites. This was the primary job of the Levites. They were scurrying about, picking up and scooping up everything that could be burned or buried and taking it off and disposing of it. But on the other hand, a lot of it just had to be washed away. And there were these huge cisterns and fountains and very, very deliberate apparati to provide water so that they could flush again and again throughout the course of the day. All of this refuse, and all of it was drained into the Brook Kedron. Because here's a curious reality. The Brook Kedron travels about 18 miles all the way down, becomes a wadi or a nahal, a riverbed that's dry much of the year, but when the rain comes, it carries the water all the way down to the Dead Sea. That's important. Because the Dead Sea is a divinely provided sewage treatment plant for what went on in the temple. Because all of that stuff is just going to be dissolved in that heavy salt water of the Dead Sea. But the point is that on that Thursday evening, as Jesus left the upper room, made his way down across the Kidron Valley and all the way across to the Gethsemane, and as he stepped across the Brook Kidron, I think that brook would have been running red with the blood of the animals that had been slain earlier that afternoon, all of which was just a picture of what Jesus is about to experience. So, I mean, it's kind of poignant that John has him stepping across the Brook Kedron and going out to Gethsemane. So, but my point is, all right, with all of that, I want to take you to John 12 because, here's where I was taking you, that he is going to Gethsemane where he, I want to take you to Gethsemane. And because I am persuaded that you really can't come to grips with Golgotha unless you start with Gethsemane. And Gethsemane is an absolutely stunning, gripping, gut-wrenching, breathtaking scene. But I think it is, and it almost seems to me almost mildly impertinent for us to peer at Gethsemane. I mean, what could be more intimate than this personal time between the Son and the Father? But God wants you to know this. He gives it to you in great detail. And I believe the reason is because you really, here's the thing. Artists of every age and every medium develop remarkable capacity to depict physical suffering. Artists can do that, right? I mean, today it's almost with all the graphics and so on, it's almost over the top, but artists can do that. How do you depict spiritual suffering? How do you give some expression to help us get some glimpse of the anguish Jesus is suffering? I think the answer is Gethsemane. And you need to understand this, folks, and I'm asking you on a Saturday morning to get serious about this. You need to understand this, that as the cross drew near, it absolutely gripped Jesus with terror. And I'm quick to say, it wasn't the physical suffering. We'll talk about that. But it wasn't the physical suffering. It was the prospect of being made sin for you and me. And it was bottomlessly terrifying. And I think that's what you see so dramatically at Gethsemane. But to really appreciate Gethsemane, I think it helps to start with John chapter 12. So let me take you there, because John 12 is, it happens on Tuesday afternoon, almost certainly. It could be Monday because John's not quite that specific. But everything, the way I understand the way the days worked out, I think almost certainly Tuesday afternoon, John chapter 12. And actually, this is a stunning passage where some Greeks have come and said, sirs, we want to see Jesus, and they're brought to Jesus, and Jesus begins to talk about dying, and he's talking about his own death, and as he does, all of a sudden, he is just gripped with angst, with anguish, and it's really kind of stunning because, see it in John 12, verse 26, or start in verse 23 is where he begins talking to these Greeks. The hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. If it dies, it produces much fruit. Now, I think Jesus is really encouraging himself. It's his own death that he's contemplating. And he's reminding himself, if you don't mind, in the face of these hearers, that it is absolutely imperative that he die. But what I want you to see is verse 27, where all of a sudden, and I always say it's almost like a Shakespearean soliloquy. I don't know anything about Shakespeare, but I know what a soliloquy is, right? Where the actor kind of breaks away from the scene and steps to the front of the stage and begins to address the heavenly. And that seems to be what's going on here, because in the middle of this conversation, all of a sudden, and I picture Jesus perhaps gripping his chest and staggering a bit and saying, "Now my soul is troubled." So he interrupts everything and says, "My soul is just so unbelievably heavy." And then he says this, "What shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose, I came to this hour." Now, what I want you to see is that as Jesus contemplates his own dying, he is so gripped that he contemplates, he considers praying, "Father," but he checks himself. He considers, "Father, deliver me." No, I can't pray that. It was for this hour, this purpose, that I came onto this hour. And Jesus prays what is as noble and selfless a prayer as there is anywhere in Scripture. And let me just tell you this, go to preaching for just a second, that, folks, whatever the terror, whatever the dread, whatever the disappointment, whatever the exigency of life that you and I might face, if by the Spirit of God we can get to the place where we're willing to pray this prayer, because what Jesus prays is, "Father, glorify your name." This is so awful, so mysterious, so dark, so terrifying. My soul is heavy, but I don't want to pray deliver me, so I'm just going to pray this. "Father, you be glorified." And you know, folks, this is all happening in real time. This is not just some play act that was scripted in eternity as just being emptily played out. This is real stuff. And the Father in heaven, his heart is so sensitive to that of the Son. And at this remarkable moment, the Father in heaven breaks protocol. And he says to the, you see it in the next verse, says, "Then a voice came from heaven saying, I have glorified it and will glorify it again." And understand, folks, that is the promise that Jesus took to the cross. What encouraged him, enabled him, fortified him, was this promise. As dark as it is, the Father said, he's going to be glorified. Now, my point in taking you there is simply this. Is it not interesting that what Jesus refused to pray on Tuesday afternoon, "What shall I pray? Father, deliver me from this hour"? No, it's for this purpose that I came to this hour. What Jesus refused to pray on Tuesday afternoon, he prayed with fervent heart three times on Thursday night. I think it gives you some picture of the terror. Now listen, let me just tell you something. When we think of death, just intuitively, we think of physical death. That pretty much exhausts our horizon. That's what death is. It's an ever-present reality. I'm an old guy. It gets close. You know what? Physical death, I'm not saying it's not important, but I'll tell you this. With God, it's an afterthought. You know how hard it is for God to fix physical death? Think about it. "Lazarus, come out here." Okay, here he comes. You know how hard it is for God to fix spiritual death? That's what's at stake. Spiritual death is the alienation of the soul spirit from God. The first time we encounter death in the Bible is Genesis 3. God says to Adam, "Don't eat. In the day you eat, you'll die." So he eats it, and 938 years later, he dies, of course. No, he died. He had known what it was to walk in the cool of the day. Now he finds himself alienated from God, offended at God, fearing God, fleeing from God. That's spiritual death. That's what, by the way, in my mind, makes hell to be hell. I believe in a hot hell, but I'm telling you something. What makes hell to be hell is the awareness that you are going to exist forever without any relationship with the God who made you to know and enjoy him, and apart from whom you can never have any measure of real satisfaction or contentment, because that's what God made you to be, made you to do. Does that make sense to you? Now, think about it. Folks, and we'll maybe refer to this in the morning, but I need to say it here. You and I believe with all of our hearts in a triune God. Amen and amen? None of us understands that. It's a mystery. There is no analogy. That's why it's so mysterious to us. If you got the water, ice, steam thing going on in your head, shame on you. Get rid of that. That's modalism. The fact is that there is no analogy, but what it teaches us, and oh, how I've learned to cherish the doctrine of a triune God, because you know what it teaches us? It teaches us that it is God's nature to exist in relationship. He cherishes relationship. He knows relationship. He nurtures relationship. He loves that in you. Now, the fact of the matter is, as a matter of fact, that's what's most precious to you and me in this life, is relationship. If you ponder unhappy thought, what might bring you to the edge of such despair that you wonder whether life is worth living, it's not going to be health or money. It's going to be relationship. Because that's how God made you. That's how God made you. We're in the image of God, and there's nothing more precious than relationship. And now you have this triune God who exists in eternity in perfect, loving, open relationship, the Father with the Son, with the Spirit. And folks, what's going to happen on the cross is, in some ultimately inscrutable sense, the Father is going to judicially disfellowship the Son. And the Son is going to cry out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Now, I think you and I will spend eternity pondering what that's about. And as we know God better, and as we understand perhaps as close as finity can get to infinity, we understand in a greater and greater way the dynamics and the blessedness of this relationship between Father, Son, and Spirit, that we will be ever more impressed with the horrors of the cross as Jesus was disfellowshipped by the Father. But that's what fills Jesus with terror. And it fills him with such terror that three times he begs the Father. Again, Tuesday after, I can't pray that. Thursday, three times. If there be any way, let this cup pass from me. Now, you know that he never stopped there. And every time he said, nonetheless, not my will, but thine be done. It's interesting that Luke gives us two insights. It's in Luke 22. You'll remember these. First of all, he says, I'm going to reverse the order, he says that Jesus sweat great drops of blood. Now, time out for those of you who have some experience with this. I know there's a text critical issue here, and I've done my homework, and these verses belong there, okay? But the fact is that Luke the doctor says that Jesus sweat great drops of blood. I'm telling you something. It says something about the physical virility of Jesus, that he could survive the kind of emotional physical pressure which is depicted, which is behind that malady where your heart beats with such a ferocity it drives your blood pressure up, and blood is forced out of the corpuscle, out of the capillaries and into the sweat glands and so on. So it's staggering that he could even survive that. But it is a quotient of Jesus' contemplation of what he's about to endure. And then in the verse before, Luke says, and this really staggers me, that the Father sent angels to assist Jesus. Now, think about this. Jesus never, ever uses his miracle-working power on his own behalf. Because he came to live your life in front of you, folks, and you can't do that. So he might have, but it's interesting that the only other time where Jesus is at such a physical extremity, as in physical danger, and he's alone and nobody to help him, and so the Father sends angels. The only other time is what? After a 40-day fast. See, now I think if it were anybody else, now I'm back in Luke 4 and Matthew 4 and Mark 1, but in the telling of the, all three synoptics make much of the fact, and John doesn't record the temptation, but the ones who do make much of the fact that Jesus fasted for 40 days. What do you look like after a 40-day fast? See the point? You are on the precipice of death. You can't move. You probably can't perambulate. You can't. Your body is covered with sores. You're just barely alive. And Jesus, like I say, if it were somebody else, Jesus might have spoken them into health. But Jesus never did that on his behalf. And so because Jesus was at such a physical extremity, the Father sent angels. Now, I think those angels spent several weeks nursing Jesus, doing what you and I would have done to nurse him back to health and so on. Now, think about this. The only other time God dispatches angels is in the Garden of Gethsemane, and it's not by reason of a 40-day fast that Jesus is physically incapacitated. It's by reason of the contemplation of what he's about to endure for you and me. And I don't know what those angels did. I picture them, if nothing else, just helping Jesus up off the ground. And it's with angelic assistance that Jesus staggers out of the garden, wakes first of all the three and then the eight. And as he leaves the garden, you remember Peter takes that sword. We'll talk about this a little later. But Peter takes that sword and swipes off of his servant's ear, and Jesus replaces the ear. I always think that was the second most amazing thing that happened that afternoon, because the first most amazing being that the soldiers went on with the arrest. You know, if I saw him pick that ear up and put it back, I'd think, you're on your own, guys. But at any rate, the point is, now think about this. Three times in the garden, if there be any way, let this cup pass from me. And Jesus says, put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup that my Father's given me? Oh, that ought to take our breath away. Listen, Gethsemane is a staggering scene. And I believe that God gives it to us to help us understand the depth of anguish and terror that the experience of the cross, not the physical suffering of the cross, but the experience of being forsaken by the Father meant to Jesus. That make sense to you? It's a hugely important scene. But now Jesus is arrested. And we come to Friday, and I like to think of Friday as a day of messianic perfection, because it's going to culminate, as it were, when Jesus cries out, it is finished. We'll talk about that tomorrow. But first of all, Friday morning, and if you go in your notes, I give you this in some detail, and this is what we're going to talk about, and then we're going to be done for the morning. Maybe take some, I'd like to leave a little time for questions if you've got them, but if you look on page 16, I give you that map that I've kind of adjusted just a little bit for reasons I'll talk about, but beginning on page 13 is a day of messianic perfection. And again, understand that very late on Thursday night, Jesus is arrested outside the Garden of Gethsemane in the Valley of Kidron on the east of Jerusalem. The plan is, as I say, to get him on a cross, on a Roman cross, condemned to die as a seditionist before the city wakes up. But that can't happen simply, because first of all, the Jewish authorities have to gather to try to come up with a charge, because their problem is they have no credible witnesses who will make the case that Jesus is in fact a seditionist, or who will testify that they have heard Jesus say aloud, I am Messiah King. That's what they're looking for, and they don't have anybody. Now, after they have exacted that confession from him, or extracted, I should say, perhaps, then they're going to take him to Pilate. So let me talk to you about, there is a series of, generally it's regarded as three Jewish hearings and three stages to the Roman trial. They're all laid out for you. Let me walk you through, first of all, the Jewish hearings. Now, I'm going to do this quickly. It's on your sheet there, but it's on your notes. But let me just say this. You will read again and again, and here we are at Easter time, and you're gonna see things on, you know, various history channels and so on, and again we are told that, and let me back up one other step. You know that there's a community of scholars, whatever you want to call them, who are desperate to discredit the Bible, right? The whole critical approach. And you know what? Those who want to attack and discredit the Bible historically, they love the Gospels. Because you got four guys telling the same story. And the one place in the Gospels, one of the places they most like, I mean, they go to and insist that absolutely no sense can be made of, is the trials. And they will say that the trial narratives are so bunged up and it's a lie. They fit together perfectly if you just trace them. And you know what? If you go into the Bible making the assumption that it's true, and you're going to stay at it until you've figured out, because you know going in that it's true. I don't believe the Bible because I've sat in judgment and decided it's inerrant. It's the Word of God. What the Bible says, God says. God's a truth teller. So I know the Bible is true in all of its parts. There is, even in the evangelical world today, this broad spirit that says, well, okay, maybe it's a mistake here and there. It's not a big deal. Well, when you have that attitude, you give up on it right away. You say, it's just another mistake. Let's go on to the next thing. There aren't any errors in the Bible. It is historically, scientifically, theologically true in all of its parts. Every truth claim it makes consists with reality. All right? That's what truth is. It's absolute truth. All right. Now, the point is this. We're told again and again that the trials are total. The stories are, the various gospels are totally contradictory. Not at all. Let me walk you through it. When Jesus is arrested, he is taken back up on the Western Hill because Caiaphas, now he's our crook who declared that Jesus had to die back there in John 11. He's the one to whom Judas had gone, but that was Caiaphas' personal home south of the city there on the Hill of Evil Council. In the walled city in Herod's day, there is a priestly villa, and whoever the high priest is gets to live in that villa. And Caiaphas had been the high priest for 18 years. And so he was well ensconced. He's a crook. But at any rate, the point is, Jesus is brought to the home of Caiaphas, but it's going to take a little time for the word to go out, maybe the Sanhedrin. It's the middle of the night. And this is a culture where your body wants to go to sleep once the sun goes down. So maybe they're just slumbering in various parts of Caiaphas's vast home and so on. But anyway, they got to get them all together and get ready. So here come the soldiers with Jesus, and they bring him to Caiaphas. But John tells us that before he's brought to Caiaphas, and only John tells us this. John is the only gospel that tells us this, but he makes a big point of it, that before they went to Caiaphas, they took him to Annas. Now, Annas is the aged father-in-law of Caiaphas. He was the high priest before. He undoubtedly has quarters there in the priestly villa, and he's anxious to hear. So they bring Jesus to Annas. And Annas, again, he's poking. He's hoping that he can find something to use against Jesus. Now, you have to understand, and I make a point of this in your notes, and it's not a happy reality, but the fact is that on this night, the Jewish authorities high-handedly, egregiously violated any number of their own protocols with regard to jurisprudence, how a man is to be tried. And one of those protocols that was violated was that you're never allowed to interrogate the accused. But that's exactly what Annas is doing. You know where that comes from, by the way? It comes from the most basic jurisprudential protocol in the Old Testament, which is in the mouth of two or three witnesses will every matter be established. So it's got to be eyewitnesses. You can't be extracting a confession out of the accused. So they knew that it was wrong. The reason we got a Fifth Amendment is because of that protocol in the Old Testament, the mouth of two or three witnesses, eyewitnesses. That's how every guilt or innocence is always established. So the point is, they bring him to Caiaphas, and Caiaphas begins to question him about his teaching and so on. And Jesus says, I always spoke in the marketplace and the synagogues. Go check with the people who hear me. Now, what he is saying is, live up to your own protocols. Go check with the witnesses. You got no right to interrogate me. Well, when Jesus said that, the high priest, Annas, had a personal soldier attendant, evidently, and he cuffed Jesus. Now, another protocol of Jewish law is you could never punish a man unless he had been convicted of a crime. So Jesus says, if I've done wickedly, bear witness against me. If not, why are you striking me? So Jesus is so very, very much in control of this entire situation, and he's simply saying, live up to your own protocols. Nothing comes of that. So now Jesus is taken to the main trial. And what happens in the main trial, this is Mark and Matthew tell us this in great detail, is that this is the middle of the night. Another protocol, this is hugely important, of Jewish jurisprudence is this. You can never have a trial between sundown and sunup. And the reason is the same thing. You got to have witnesses, and this culture goes to sleep. So you can't have a trial between sundown and sunup. But they're doing it. It's illegal, and they call witnesses. Another protocol, by the way, is, and this is a happy thing, if in a capital trial, in other words, it's going to eventuate in the execution of the accused if he's found guilty, any two witnesses disagree, you immediately release the prisoner. If any two supposed eyewitnesses tell stories that are different, you immediately set them free. Well, that's exactly what happened. They didn't set them free, but they disagreed with one another. They couldn't find any witnesses that could bear testimony. And so this is what happens, finally. And I picture, you know, the clock is kind of ticking. By the way, they have a 4:30 date. I'll tell you how I come to that, with Pilate. And they need an accusation. And they don't have anybody who can make a credible case that Jesus is, in fact, claiming to be a king. They haven't heard him say it in a way that will convince the Romans. So finally, Caiaphas, and I picture him kind of quieting down the crowd, the Sanhedrin, 70 men or so, all sitting in judgment on Jesus. And here stands Jesus, and by now he's been mildly misused, but he's been hauled up. He's undoubtedly in chains. And I picture Caiaphas saying, "All right, quiet." And he turns to Jesus, and he does what's wrong. He puts him under oath. He's going to interrogate him. And he says, "I adjure thee." In other words, I put you under oath. Tell us, are you the Christ, the Son of the living God? Now, again, that's exactly what Jesus had claimed, but he had been so circumspect that they couldn't find anybody who could remember hearing him say, "I am the Christ." That makes sense to you? And I think Caiaphas is clutching at straws here. I think but to his delight and surprise, Jesus says, "I am." We got him that quick. We got him. We just had 70 men hear him claim to be Messiah. Messiah means king. Rome can't stand kings. And so we got him. So they think now everything's in readiness, except for this, that what they've done is high-handedly illegal by their own protocols, and Pilate is not anxious to play along. And they're afraid that he might just throw this whole thing out when he finds out it was a nocturnal trial, so they decide we'll do this. And this is where I come up with a 4:30. Matthew and Mark both reference this. Luke tells it in great detail, that what happened is they put Jesus in hold for a time. Now, by the way, this is Caiaphas's villa. It would have been expansive. It included a building with a room large enough you could get 70 people in there for the trial and so on. It also would have had a courtyard and a lot of installations and cisterns and wine cellars and so on. And you remember that while this is happening, Peter has made his way into that courtyard. Jesus has been hauled off through the courtyard and probably put in some wine cellar, some hold, because they're waiting for the first blush of dawn, just the first little hint of gray light on the eastern horizon. And they're going to haul him back in and get him to say this again so that they can insist that they did it after sunup. Does that make sense to you? Because it's illegal to do it between sundown and sunup. So Jesus is held for a time. It's during that time that the Roman soldiers blindfold him, cuff him, tell us who it was. Very possibly, this is when his beard was plucked, because the Old Testament anticipates that. It's not in the gospel record. But at any rate, he's being abused. Now comes the first blush of dawn. The Sanhedrin's reconvene, and they send the soldiers, "Go bring him back in here." Meanwhile, Peter is standing at a fire. He's already twice. What also happens at the first blush of dawn? See, this is the point. The rooster is going to crow. And so he's standing there, warming his hands. And I don't think it has to be the first rooster in the morning, whatever. It's just that it's a rooster close by. He's warming his hands. And Jesus had said, "Before the rooster crows, you're going to deny me three times." He'd said that the night before. Can you imagine what was going through Peter's head when Jesus said that? I mean, they're in the upper room. They're expecting to lay back and go to sleep. Jesus says, Peter must have thought, "Am I going to do this in my sleep? What in the world are you talking about?" But now it plays out. He's in the courtyard. He's warming his hands for a third time. He says, "I never knew the man." And he turns. The Bible says Jesus turned and looked upon Peter. How came they to be together? Do you see what's at stake? Peter's in the courtyard. Jesus has been put in hold for a time. He's being hauled back into the main room through the courtyard. As he's being dragged back in chains, he looks on Peter. And while the words are still echoing in the wind, the rooster crows, and Peter goes out and weeps bitterly. Remember that? So now Jesus is brought in, and you have the third stage of the Jewish trial. It's not a trial. It's a hearing. It's an attempt to come up with an indictment. But they simply say to Jesus once again, tell us, are you the Christ? And Jesus says, I'm not going to confess to that. And then they say, okay, are you the Christ, the Son of the living God? Jesus demands that it be exactly as he claimed. And Jesus once again says, I am. So now, that's why I say, and I have sat up and listened for roosters and looked at the eastern horizon in Jerusalem and this season of the year, and I think it's about 4:30 in the morning that you would have just the, and all three Gospels say it was very early, just as the dawn is starting to break. Because, now watch this, folks, it's a little technical. Are you with me still? I know it's time for lunch, isn't it? But I'm hurrying. Folks, in John 19:14, it says that when Pilate turned Jesus over to be crucified, it was about the sixth hour. That's Roman time. That's 6 a.m. Some discussion, but that's 6 a.m. So we've only got about an hour and a half to work with here, because about 4:30, the Jews, the Jewish leadership, the city is asleep, but the Jewish leadership, having finally extracted from Jesus the confession openly that he is the Messiah, and that's what's incendiary. What really angers the Jews is his claim to be God come into flesh. But what is going to be tinder that they can use to excite the Romans about him is his claim to be Messiah. Does that make sense to you? So now they're going to take him to Pilate. And I want to talk to you. It's take me about 15 minutes and then we're going to be done. Can you handle that? I want to talk to you about the man Pilate. And I deliberately got myself here. Pilate is going to ultimately turn Jesus over to be crucified, and Jesus is going to be held for a time, and by about 9 o'clock in the morning, the third hour, according to Jewish time, Jesus is on a cross. And we'll talk about the actual event of the crucifixion and then the resurrection tomorrow morning. But it's Pilate who turns Jesus over to be crucified. So let me just walk you through. And there is a verse in 1 Timothy 6 that really got my attention some years ago. And that's kind of animates this discussion. And it's where Paul says to Timothy in a very kind of incidental, almost offhanded way, he says, I adjure thee by the living God and by the good confession that Jesus witnessed before Pontius Pilate. And as I read that, I thought, you know, evidently, early Christians, including Timothy, really went to school on the way Jesus handled himself before Pontius Pilate, because Paul could just kind of offhandedly say, you know, press yourself into the mold of Jesus before Pontius Pilate. And he must have understood that drama. Timothy must have, and I determined to spend a little time with it. And I want to walk you through it, but let me just tell you this. There are three kind of stages. Here, I'll tell them to you. First of all, they bring Jesus to Pilate in that place on the outside of the Praetorium. And Pilate says, what's the accusation? They say, look, if he weren't a malefactor, we wouldn't have brought him to you, just crucify him. Now, I think what they're saying is, Pilate, we made the deal. Just crucify him, for heaven's sakes. And Pilate says, no, I'm not going to do that. So Pilate takes Jesus indoors, and you have an amazing conversation between Jesus and Pilate. Then Pilate comes out, and for the first of five times that are explicit in the record, the only and fully authorized judge of this trial declares Jesus innocent. The man is guiltless. Well, his accusers, the city's still asleep, but his accusers begin to cry out, no, no, he's a troublemaker, he's a seditionist, he's made trouble ever since Galilee. Well, when Pilate heard the word Galilee, he thought, hold on here, I'm not in charge of Galilee. That's Herod Antipas. He's also in town, so he sends him to Herod. This is Herod Antipas. This is Herod the Great's son. His home is Tiberias, and his region is Galilee and Perea, but he's in town for the feast, and so he sends Jesus to Herod Antipas. Herod Antipas is making merry. He just wants to see a miracle. Jesus is moot. He never says a thing. So he sends him back. I'm convinced that in the meanwhile, Pilate, who desperately doesn't want to crucify Jesus. Peter says this. Peter in Acts 3 says to his contemporaries, you crucified Jesus when Pilate was determined to let him go. I'm going to tell you something. I am more than a little bit suspicious that we're going to see Pilate in heaven. Now, that's not the usual read on Pilate. And I can tell you exactly why Pilate is made into the villain. You simply read the story. Pilate is not a primary villain in this story. And almost everything Pilate does is unspeakably noble. He makes every, and this is what happens. I think Pilate had sent him off to Herod Antipas. He really had no confidence that that was going to resolve the issue. He'd like to see it, so he didn't have to handle this. But in the meanwhile, he had thought, I got an idea. Because you see, this is when the city starts to wake up. The sun is starting to come up. And once the word got out that Jesus was on trial before Pilate, people would have started swelling there and so on. So I think Pilate looks out and, all right, now let me suspend it right there. And let me just tell you this. This is kind of big to me, so forgive me. But there are two places. Can you see this at all? There are two places that are suggested as where Jesus was tried before Pilate. Now, let me do this. The one is here, the Fortress Antonia, way up to the north, and it's wrong. I'll just tell you, it's wrong. It's where the Via Dolorosa is. It's where no early tradition has it there. But what happened is when the Crusaders came there in the 12th century, they, number one, they slaughtered everybody, Jewish, Christian, Muslim. They destroyed the community memory, and then they set out to recover some holy sites, and they decided that Jesus must have been tried there in the Fortress Antonia. Now, understand this. Now that I got into it, I got to say, Pilate doesn't live in Jerusalem. He lives in Caesarea Maritima, where he's got a beautiful palace that Herod the Great had built down there and sticking out into the Mediterranean Sea. So, but he comes up to Jerusalem for special seasons. So now the question is, where would he stay? And the Crusaders came up with the cockamamie idea, quite honestly, that he stayed in the Fortress Antonia, and therefore all the commotion and the churches and the people carrying the crosses, the Via Dolorosa is all up there in the north end of the city. It's the wrong place, okay? And almost, I only know of one competent scholar who is resisting this. Everybody else is saying, of course, it's not. Where it happened is here at Herod's palace. It's on the west side of the city. Now, you got to understand, one of the arguments that was always used, or is always used, there aren't very many people making this argument. One of the arguments they would use to defend the Antonia is, okay, see, because I'm asking people all the time, if you're going up to Jerusalem, you're the prefect, you're in charge here, you're the Roman officer, where are you going to stay? In the barracks with the soldiers, or in this beautiful palace that Josephus says next to the temple, the most breathtakingly beautiful facility Herod ever built was his own palace. It had huge buildings with dozens and scores of rooms and banquet halls. It had bathhouses. It had a lazy river. It had all sorts of gardens. And people say, well, it'd be more comfortable there, but he wanted to be safe. Do you know Herod? Herod was the most paranoid man on the face of the earth. And his palace was a fortress, three huge defensive towers and so on. There was no place safer than Herod's. And he had built, we're told in the literature, in the southern end of his beautiful, it was about a fifth of a mile long. And it's just stunning. And, I mean, it's not much left of it today. You can walk through the airspace. But in the southern end, he had built a beautiful barracks for his own Praetorian Guard. So he had his own guard in the temple. I'm sorry, not the, in his palace. This is where Pilate would be staying when he came up for the feast. And this is where Jesus was tried before Pilate. And I give you a picture here that, this right here is the actual wall today. This wall right here is a modern wall. It was built by Suleiman the Magnificent in the 1540s, so it's a modern wall, but it follows precisely Herod's wall. And these rocks right down here are Herodian. We know that this is Herod's wall. And, I'd love to tell you about it, but this was covered with dirt until about 15 years ago. And when they uncovered it, they found, as a matter of fact, I'll show you here, the archaeologist, I spent time with the archaeologist here, and he was part of digging this out and finding this gate. And he says, right here, can you see that at all? That's an arrow slit. See where it is on a wall? He says, whenever I'd come to work, I was about 13 years old, and I volunteered to be part of this. Is Shimon Gibson. He said, I put my lunch in that arrow slit. But you see, all of this was covered with dirt. And they dug away that dirt, and they found this marvelous walkway. They found a gate right there. And this is a depiction of it down here in the south. And there, down here in the bottom. This is an artist's reconstruction with a gate here and this marvelous walkway, which is this right here. And then there was a raised area. You can barely see this, but right here is a bema seat. And they found vestiges of the bema seat. And that's where Pilate stood and tried Jesus. Now, I just love this because you go up there to the Fortress Antonia area to the north, the city of Jerusalem, and it's all busy and narrow streets and the Via Dolorosa and the stations and people tripping over each other and so on. You go down here, we always do it in the evening. The moon is bright. You got this broad spreading lawn, and you can see right where Jesus stood. There's the gate. But I say all that just to make the point that I love this story. But and it is in this gate right here that Pilate twice takes Jesus inside. The word praetorium is the official word for the residence of the most senior Roman official. So wherever he's staying, his home is the praetorium. Well, when he was in town in Jerusalem, the praetorium was Herod's palace. And Herod, we know all about this gate, and it's been dug very, very carefully, and Gibson says there's no doubt there was a gate there, and it featured this raised platform where Pilate could be inside this double gate. There was an outer gate and an inner gate, so he's outside the praetorium, but he's in this secure area, but it's constructed so he can speak to masses of people. And that's why I think Pilate is standing, and he sees the city waking up, and he thinks to himself, I'll go over the heads of the Jewish leadership. So he turns to the people and he says, you know that at Passover, it's our custom to release a prisoner. Who would you have me give you, Barabbas or Jesus? And I think Pilate is, because he's got Sunday, Monday, Tuesday ringing in his ears. He's thinking these people love Jesus. This will be their opportunity. And the Bible says that the chief priest persuaded the people to say, give us Barabbas. And I think Pilate was stunned. As a matter of fact, he goes on to say, well, what would you have me do with Jesus, whom you call the Christ? They cry out, crucify him. That's where they are announcing their verdict, given the decision to which Jesus pressed them last Tuesday afternoon. Does that make sense to you? And then Pilate tries something else. And that is, he takes Jesus in the praetorium, I think, probably to near that garrison of soldiers, and Jesus is scourged. Now, it's brutal, but you know what? I think there is a sense in which it is, hold on to your seats, kind. Because Pilate is trying to release Jesus. And after scourging him, he puts that cheap robe and that crown of thorns, brings Jesus out, stands him, I think, right in that gateway that I've circled there. And there stands Jesus, bloody and just beyond what we can imagine, scarred and bloodied, and now with this reproach of the thorns and so on. And Pilate stands there and he says, behold the man. Now, what's Pilate saying? I think he's saying, look at him. You're telling me this is a threat to Rome. I'm telling you, the man is innocent. I'm not going to crucify him. But his enemies continue to cry out, crucify him. And Pilate, for the fifth time in John 19, announces, the man is innocent. I'm not going to crucify him. And when he does, the Jewish leaders play, well, they say this, and this is John 19, verse 7, and in so many ways, theologically, this drama turns on this verse. Because in John 19, verse 7, the Jewish leaders say this, if you won't crucify him as a seditionist, we have a law. And by our law, he ought to die because he made himself the Son of God. And you need to understand, and folks, can I just warn you, you're going to hear in the next few weeks, because it's Easter time. There's going to be a lot of attention. Praise God for that. But I hear it carelessly said, and I'd invite you to become a little bit sensitive to this. You'll hear it said, basically, that Jesus died having been convicted of sedition. We got to tease this out. Because on the one hand, he absolutely, explicitly, in the record, died having been exonerated of sedition again and again and again. And yet, and this is huge, and we'll talk about it tomorrow morning, he died the death that Rome had designed for a seditionist. Does that make sense to you? He died a seditionist death, but he died that death having been carefully and publicly and emphatically exculpated of sedition by the only constituted judge in the whole drama. Now, here's where I'm taking you, and this will take me just a couple minutes. Go to John 18, because go back to that where that I mentioned before, where Paul says to Timothy, he adjures him by the living God and by the good confession. He makes allusion to the good confession that Jesus witnessed before Pontius Pilate. That's 1 Timothy 6:13. Well, the curious reality is that in all that I just described to you, other than in that initial interview with Annas, before the Annas doesn't even apply, in all of the Roman trials, Jesus never speaks. So, except when he's alone with Pilate inside the praetorium. Now, I didn't finish, by the way. After Pilate had said, "Behold the man," he screamed, "Behold the man, I'm not going to crucify him," and the Jews had said, "Well, he ought to die because he makes himself the Son of God. By our law, he ought to die." The Bible says that Pilate was the more afraid, and he took Jesus inside a second time. So there are these two times, John 18 and John 19, where Pilate takes Jesus alone in the praetorium, I think in that gate that I've circled, and it's just Pilate and Jesus alone, and this has to be the good confession that Jesus testified before witness, before Pontius Pilate, because it's the only time he speaks in the records. That make sense to you? So let's think about it, and this we're done. In John 18, now I'm going to get myself inordinately whipped up here, I'll just warn you, but in John 18, the Bible says, all right, John 18 and verse 28 is where the Jewish leaders bring Jesus. About 4:30 in the morning, this is where they come, and they don't want to enter in lest they defile themselves. So Pilate has set up his apparatus outside the praetorium in the scene that I described. And this is where Pilate says, "What's the accusation?" And they refuse. If he weren't a malefactor, we wouldn't have brought him to you. Just crucify him. And so Pilate, because he is the judge, takes Jesus inside. Look at verse 33. Pilate entered the praetorium again, and he called Jesus. So this is the first of two times where you have only Jesus and Pilate alone in the praetorium. And I want you to trace this. Pilate says to Jesus, "Are you the King of the Jews?" You see it right there in verse 33. Pilate entered the praetorium again, and he called Jesus and said, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Now, folks, let's live this out with Jesus, all right? I want you to think about this. And this is one of those places where I'm telling you, it's really important to take Jesus' humanity very seriously. Because what's at stake here, and what I think is so instructive, and part of what Timothy is being encouraged, the mold he's being encouraged to press him into, is Jesus' carefulness here, because Pilate has asked a cripplingly ambiguous question. Get the scene. It's just Jesus and Pilate. By the way, by Roman law, because Jesus wasn't a citizen, Pilate could interrogate, he could do anything he wanted to him. So this was entirely legitimate by Roman law, and the judge takes him in and says, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Well, now hear it. On the one hand, Pilate might be saying, he seems most likely, he's saying, "Are you a seditionist? Are you a pretender king? Are you a threat to Rome?" As these Sanhedrinists are insisting. What's the answer to that? No, and it can't be confused. He's not a seditionist, and that record cannot be compromised in that regard. On the other hand, and you may think, "Oh, that's not," but you wait. He might have been asking, "Are you the Messiah, King of Israel?" Well, what's the answer to that? Well, absolutely is. And so Jesus, because, and folks, you know what? It could be that in days to come, you and I will stand we'll find ourselves in one level or another standing before some hostile, angry political authority who is upset with us because we insist on taking the stand we take in the Bible. And this is the pattern. I think that's what he's saying. Go to school on this. So here he stands before the judge, and the judge has said, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Now, I'm going to say again, if the Spirit of God had ministered to Jesus the direction to know Pilate's mind, he could have done, but he didn't. So Jesus had to ask, and he does. He asked the question in verse 34, "Are you speaking for yourself about this, or did others tell you this concerning me?" So he's saying, are you asking me out of your heart whether or not I'm the king of the Jews? Are you asking me about what people have said concerning me? And now Pilate straightens it out. In the next verse, Pilate said, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you to me as a judge," is his point. "What have you done?" So now Pilate has specified his question. I am asking you, are you guilty of sedition? Now, let me just tell you something, folks, and here's where I can get myself inordinately worked up, but this next verse, verse 36, is so precious, but it's a verse which has been so misused. And without getting too deeply into it, let me just say this, that I told you before, I'm a fire-eating premillennialist. There are those, and they're quite dominant, who reject all of that, and they insist that Jesus didn't come to offer the kingdom, but to redefine the kingdom, and what he really meant to offer was a spiritual kingdom, and there never will be a physical kingdom. And that's called amillennialism, and I respect it, though I reject it. But I like to say, I got a lot of amillennial friends, and I would guess that if any one of them accidentally dropped his Bible, it would flop open to this verse. You know what I'm saying? This is their verse. They love this verse. Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world, so it can't be a physical kingdom." All right, now let's think. Number one, Jesus is on trial for his life. He is alone with Pilate in the praetorium. It is about 4:30 in the morning. He has been asked by a duly constituted judge a legitimate question. Are you a seditionist? That's the question. He just asked it. So Jesus seizes the moment to deliver himself of a one-sentence lecture on kingdom theology that totally unsays everything the Old Testament ever said. I don't think so. I don't think that's what's going on here, for heaven's sakes. And one of the things that bothers me about this, the way this verse is, in my mind, so thoroughly misused, is that we don't spend any time to ask what Jesus is saying. Think about this. Pilate, from this moment forward, from this exchange, Pilate is going to be absolutely convinced that Jesus is not a seditionist. And against unbelievable pressure, and in spite of the fact that the simplest thing in the world would be for him to just cave in and say, okay, go crucify him. We don't need a riot here. Pilate refuses. How came Pilate to that persuasion? The answer is Jesus makes an absolutely airtight legal argument here. And it is so thoroughly convincing that Pilate never wavers after this moment. So he gets Jesus in, he asks a question. It's a legitimate question. Are you a seditionist? Are you guilty of what they're accusing you of? And Jesus says, now think about it. My kingdom is not of this world. Well, I wonder what he means by of this world. Maybe we should read the next sentence. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I be not taken. But my kingdom does not come in this fashion. That's what he means. I think, honest to goodness, I think maybe Pilate stood back. It's just him and Jesus in the praetorium. And I think maybe he rubbed his chin and he said, boy, I don't live in a cave. Jesus hasn't lived in a cave. For 3 years, he's been going up and down this countryside, causing more excitement than we can hardly believe. Not one of his followers ever lifted a sword. I think Pilate probably thought to himself, you know, we've had plenty of experience with seditionists here in Israel, and they all do the same thing. They find themselves some false Messiah, and he finds himself some fastness, you know, some readout or hideout in the Jeshimon, and he gets a little militia, and he comes out at night, and he falls on the Romans, and we got to send soldiers. We've never, ever had this, by the way, is why it was so important for Peter to put his sword away the night before, because Jesus has to be able to make this argument that my servants don't fight. And I'm telling you, folks, it is an absolutely airtight legal argument, so persuasive that the only judge in a place becomes unalterably convinced that this man is not a seditionist. Does that make sense to you? Now, what I love is the next verse. And this is staggering. Because now, Pilate says to Jesus, John 18, next verse, he says, verse 27, Pilate therefore said to him, well, are you a king then? Now listen, folks, this has nothing to do with the legal proceedings. Pilate is something of a seeker. And he says, well, are you a king? And I love Jesus' answer. Jesus was a premillennialist. Jesus said, you say, now imagine this. He looked Pilate, the Roman prefect, right in the eye, and he said, you say rightly that I am a king. It was for this purpose that I was born. It was for this purpose that I came into this world. And anybody who cherishes the truth is going to embrace this. How did he say it? Everyone who is of the truth is going to hear my voice. You say rightly that I'm a king. What is stunning is that on the one hand, Jesus was so jealous for the truth. So when Pilate asked him an ambiguous, crippling question, he sorted it out. He wanted to make sure the record was clear. And number two, he was, I think, Jesus loved Pilate. And Pilate asked him an honest question. Are you a king? Are you the Messiah of Israel? What else can he mean? And Jesus affirms, you absolutely, I'm the king. And of course, he says, everyone who is of the truth is going to hear my voice. And Pilate throws his hands in the air and says, what is truth? All right, now, fast forward, and I'm done. Now, Pilate goes out for the first time. The man is innocent. Oh, he's a troublemaker ever since Galilee. Herod Antipas, off to Herod Antipas. Doesn't work. Comes back. How about Barabbas? No, give us Barabbas. Scourges him. Says, behold the man. Have you had enough, for heaven's sakes? The man's not a threat. But they say, crucify him. And he says, and you'll see it right there in John 19 and verse 5, where it says, he says, behold the man. And when the chief priests and officers saw him in John 19, they cried out saying, crucify him. Pilate said, you take him and crucify him. I find no fault in him. Do you realize how staggeringly important it is that that's the fifth time that the judge has said explicitly, the man is not a seditionist. I'm not going to crucify him as a seditionist. And that's when, verse 7, they said, well, then by our law he ought to die because he made himself the Son of God. And look at verse 8. When Pilate heard that, he was the more afraid, and he went again into the praetorium. Now, this is a staggering scene, and I want you to take it home with you. And I'm going to suggest some elements how to read it, but you spend some time with it. Because he went back, he called, verse 9, he went again into the praetorium and he said to Jesus, and I love this, can you imagine this? He takes Jesus alone. Now here's Jesus, by now bloodied, scourged, manacled, and Pilate takes him in and he says, where are you from? You hear what he's saying? Who in the world are you? There are hundreds of people in this land who have been healed by you, and yet this nation is, who in the world are you? And Jesus is absolutely mute. He won't speak. And Pilate gets frustrated, and he says to him, verse 10, are you not speaking to me? Do you not know that I have power to crucify you and power to release you? And then Jesus says, and I'm going to put a spin on this that is going to be new to you, but I'm convinced I'm right. I'm not alone, but I'm convinced that the way we often read this is wrong, because Jesus says in verse 11, now you got to get the picture. Pilate, where are you from? You're not going to speak to me? I have the power to release you or put you to death. And Jesus says, you could have no power at all against me unless it had been given you from above. Now, the standard way, I think, in our circles to read that is to from above, from my Father in heaven. I don't think that's what he means. For two reasons. Number one, I don't think that would be appropriate. I really don't. I don't think Jesus is rebuking Pilate here. I don't think he's being snarky, if you don't mind. You know, Pilate, don't take so much to yourself. It's my Father that's in control of this whole thing. I don't think it's appropriate. But more importantly, I can't make any sense of the next sentence if that's what he means. Because he goes on to say, therefore, the one who turned me over to you, that's Caiaphas, has the greater sin. How does it make any sense? Pilate, don't take so much to yourself. My Father is really in control here. Therefore, it's very explicit in the Greek, therefore, the one who turned me over to you has the greater sin. I can't make any sense of that. How does it follow that Caiaphas is the greater sinner because God is in control? I think from above means from the authorities above you. I think Jesus is saying, Pilate, you would have no authority whatever except that you were assigned this jurisdiction. You didn't hunt me down. This is not your fight. The only reason you're here is because you were assigned this jurisdiction. Now it makes all the sense in the world. Therefore, the one who has the greater sin is the one who turned me over to you. This is really Caiaphas's evil effort. Does that make sense to you? I think that's what he's saying. And I think, furthermore, that probably what Pilate is saying is not, in the earlier verse, you're not going to speak to me, don't you know I have power to set you free? I think what Pilate is saying is, Jesus, you're not even speaking to me. Don't you realize the assignment I've been given? I got to make a decision here. It's up to me to decide whether you live or die. Help me here. And Jesus says, you know, you'd have no authority whatever, except it was assigned you by the Roman authorities above you. They gave you this jurisdiction. And the real crime is that of Caiaphas. So what's Jesus doing? I think he is giving Pilate permission to go ahead. I really do. I think you got to understand the real dynamics of this situation. Jesus has to go to the cross. Pilate has a role to play. Quite frankly, Pilate has discovered, if you don't mind, a reserve of character that most people might not have suspected of him. And the Bible is explicit in the narrative and the comment by Peter that Pilate was determined. That's what Peter says. He was determined to let Jesus go. He desperately didn't want to crucify Jesus. But it has to happen. Now, 2 points and I'm done. Number one, as what happens is Pilate goes back out. And again, the Bible says he tried harder to release Jesus. But now the Jewish authorities, if you don't mind, played their trump card. And they said, if you don't crucify him, we're going to tell Caesar. And as I said, Pilate knew that he'd used up all of his coupons back there in Rome. But I think it's with Jesus' voice echoing in Pilate's mind that he calls for a basin, makes a ceremony of washing his hands. I picture him turning and going over to the gate, coming down the steps from the beam into the gate, laying down that rag and saying over his shoulder, you do with him what you will. And he goes in. Now, what's interesting, and I gotta tell you, I believe Jesus powerfully impacted this man, Pilate. And matter of fact, I like to say, and maybe my imagination's getting away with me here, but I like to say that I kind of picture Jesus when Pilate said, you're not speaking to me, don't you realize I got to make a decision? I like to picture Jesus maybe taking those manacled hands and stepping forward and putting his arms on Pilate's shoulders and looking right in the face and saying, Pilate, you'd have no authority at all except you were assigned this jurisdiction. This is Caiaphas' wicked fight. And now Pilate walks away and says, you do what you will. But I'll tell you something, the story doesn't end there. And this is why I say, I think. See, because I think it's so important to understand that Jesus was jealous for the truth, but he was jealous for the man Pilate and the way he handled himself. Because in John 19, we're told that Pilate, now you got to understand something. Okay, I'm done. You got to understand. I keep thinking of thoughts, and then you think, oh, no, I'm so hungry. But real quickly, crucifixion was not about primarily executing the seditionist. Crucifixion was about putting down the sedition. So it was a cruel, extended, gruesome, we'll talk about it in the morning, object lesson, all of which was designed to retard whatever seditious impulse might be simmering in the heart of any other of the local people. And one part of that was that when a man died the death of a seditionist, there was a banner, there was a titulus, as it was called. And it proclaimed that this man had raised his hand against Rome. You don't raise your hand against Rome. So there was a titulus. And it was written in three languages. You didn't have to do that. And it said, you'll see it there in John 19, verse 19, Pilate wrote a title, he put it on the cross, and it said, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. And when Jesus' Sanhedrin, his enemies, saw that, they were horrified. They came back in and look at it in verse 21. The chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, don't write the King of the Jews. Write, he said, I am the King of the Jews. Did you hear that? That's sedition. Write that he's a seditionist. And Pilate said, what I have written, I have written. Now, I cannot help but connect that part of the story to what Jesus had said to Pilate just a few minutes earlier. You say rightly that I'm a king. It was for this reason that I was born, for this reason I came into the world, and anybody who loves the truth is going to hear my voice. I am a king. Pilate put his career and maybe his life on the line when he emblazoned on that cross, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. This is Rome. There's no room for any king but Caesar. Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. It's a remarkable confession. And that's why I say I think very possibly Jesus had that kind of impact on this man Pilate. So I'll leave it there. Jesus is turned over to be crucified. John 19, 14 says it was 6 o'clock in the morning, the sixth hour, Roman time. And by 9 o'clock, he's going to be hanging on a cross. And we'll pick up the story there in the morning and get to the empty tomb as well. All right, thank you so much. It's been a long morning for you, so thank you for staying with me. Let me have a... Yeah, that's nice. That's nice. Thank you so much. Let me just have a quick word of prayer. Is that all right, Kevin? Is that appropriate? What are you going to argue? But all right, let me just pray with you. Our Father in heaven, we do thank you so much for, first of all, we thank you for this marvelous narrative. And Father, it just takes our breath away. And it is the most blessed and important story in all of human history. And so, Father, we thank you for the God-breathed record that we find, and we thank you for the fact that we can harmonize those gospels and come together, come away with an understanding of this marvelous, marvelous story. And, Father, we worship you, first of all, for who you are, to be sure you are our God and our Maker, but then we worship you for what you have wrought on our behalf. And you surround us every day of our lives with so many evidences of what a good and giving and gracious God you are. But above all other things, there is this, that you so loved us. You so loved us, you gave us your Son. And we worship you for that, and we thank you for the life that he lived. It was a life we never could have lived because it was an innocent life. And then the death that he died, a death that was sufficient to cover your holiness. It was a death we could have never died. But Father, we thank you for the price that he paid. And it was certainly a price we never could have paid. So Father, I'd ask that you just impress upon our hearts this reality that we have been bought with a price. And it's a dear price. And it's a price that was offered in order that we might know you as our Father. So we rejoice over that. We rejoice over the gift of your Son. And we rejoice over the opportunity which is ours now to glorify you. And might that be our commitment and our experience by your Spirit. Thank you again for the gift of your Son. And we pray in his name, amen.